The June 18th Select Board meeting, which is called to order at 6:33. Before we get too into this, I will note that we're not getting good acoustics here in this room. If it's possible, Amherst media person, to turn up the speakers in here so we can hear ourselves better. It's getting better by the moment. Perfect. Thank you very much. It really makes a big difference to us being able to, when we know we're speaking directly into the mic, because we get that that positive reinforcement that we can hear ourselves. All right. So this is the June 18th Select Board meeting. We don't have anyone here for public comment, and I will note that our 6:45 item, in case anyone is rushing down here, our 6:45 item is a public hearing for the Hess Express new wine and malt liquor license. At 6:45, we will open that public hearing and then have a motion to continue it. There's been a request to continue it by the applicant, so we will not actually be considering that item tonight. We will be considering that on July 16th, just in case anyone is watching and wondering right now. But in the meantime, we will do some untimed items, and we will do them very slowly because we have so much time to kill tonight because of this public hearing thing on gap in the agenda that... who knows? Okay. Oh, and the other thing I'll note is that when we do finish here, we are scheduled to have an executive session this evening. So just for folks to keep that in mind. And as we go through the untimed items, once we're done with them, we will do what we do in these situations when we run out of things and we have extra time, which is we'll start at the end of the agenda and work our way backwards because people aren't typically tuning in for things like the chair's report and liaison reports. So that's the plan. Before we get started with untimed items, does anybody have any announcements they would like to make? No such luck. Mr. Hayden.
Well, yeah, I just want to say that the Taste of Amherst last week was well attended by good weather and had seemed to have the benefit of spreading the crowds out over all 4 days. And it was, I saw many of you there, but it was a good show.
It was a terrific event, and really the weather could not have been any nicer. It was magnificent. I always feel bad that the students missed that event. It's one of Amherst's great events. So.
A lot of fun.
It was. Anyone else? Announcements? Mr. Wald?
Just things that are on the town website and the calendar, but you can correct me if I'm wrong. We have the public forum on the Hawthorne property coming up this week, and that's Tuesday, right? Tomorrow night,
the 19th at 7 p.m. in this room.
And on the 20th, we have the Citizen Zoning Forum, I believe, at
5 p.m. in this room.
Thank you. Excellent points on both of those. Any other announcements? Ms. Brewer, you always like to make announcements, surely, on this evening of so much time to kill.
And, now I don't need to, and I know we're going to talk about the pool later.
All right, then we will get right into the untimed items then. Tax title custodian. We have memo and information in our packets about this. This is a request to name the tax collector, Claire McGinnis, as the tax title custodian, the person who would preside over foreclosed properties that the town ends up acquiring. In the Town Government Act, it says it would be the select board or its designee, and certainly we would like to designate such a thing. We have all the information for folks who are following along at home. There's information about this on our web packet for this meeting. Does anybody have any questions or additional information about this? Mr. Musanti?
This comes with my strong recommendation. Our treasurer collector, Claire McGinnis, is our point person on property tax collection and dealing with the relatively low number of properties that, you know, become delinquent in taxes. And there's a whole process to dispose of property through a public bid process so we can get properties that we have, a handful that we've taken over the years for non-payment of taxes back onto the tax roll. So it's appropriate that our in-house expert in this area, the treasurer collector, be officially designated in that role, and she can proceed.
How has that proceeded in the past without such a designation?
Well, there's been relatively little activity. I can tell you in my 5 or so years as treasurer, there was one parcel that was through an auction process, and we ended up selling that tiny sliver of land in a subdivision to abutters, the immediate abutters, was not aware that this was an issue. And in Claire's work researching the next batch, this was brought to our attention, and this is the remedy.
Thank you. Ms. Stein?
I was wondering if there was a list of the properties anywhere.
We can get you a list.
I was just curious. Forever.
Further discussion, Mr. Hayden.
So if we don't do this, then we, the five of us, have to play that role, whatever it is, and it's not, you know, clear to me exactly what we would have to sit through and sign and what extra meetings we'd have to schedule.
Right, or, you know, designating someone else, but to me, having the person who deals most closely with property owners, current and former, or prospective, would be the treasure collector.
So auctioning them off ourselves and splitting the proceeds to make up for that $300 a year thing just isn't one of the options. Oh, well. Ms. Stein, would you like to make the motion?
Sure. I move that the Select Board appoint Claire McGinnis, treasurer/collector, to serve as custodian of properties on behalf of the Town of Amherst in accordance with the provisions of MGL Chapter 60, Section 77B.
Second.
Further discussion. Ms. Brewer.
And, of course, we've been talking about a tax title custodian, but the motion's actually for a custodian of properties, which doesn't include the word tax or title in it. So can we add something to the motion that wouldn't mess up what legal relevance, which I'm sure it must have, or they wouldn't have written it that way for us?
I think that is entirely fine, adding the words tax title prior to the word custodian. The Mass General Law chapter and section lays that out in detail, but that removes all doubt.
Right. Yeah. Then we know we're talking about the same thing. That's great.
Further discussion, Mr. Hayden.
Yeah, I just wanted to voice my appreciation for getting this. I mean, it's these little details that can really mess things up if they're not done right down the road, and I'm glad to get caught and that we can think about them and say yes.
Indeed. All right. Further discussion. All in favor, say aye.
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 Aye. That is unanimous. All right, going down the line here, we have set fall town meeting dates. So this is when we typically do this, so that people have nice advance warning, and so we can set the calendar with the deadlines for warrant articles, etc., because the next town meeting is always just around the corner. Typically, town meeting starts the first Monday in November, but this November is the presidential election, and the town clerk's office has asked that we not start it on the night before or the night after the election when they are really immersed in a huge amount of work. So then that put us to the next week, and well, wouldn't you know that the second Monday in October this year is the observance of Veterans Day. Okay, so that put us to the second Wednesday. Well, that middle school auditorium is already reserved for a choral concert. So now we are looking to start on our best case scenario is the third Monday in November, which is the 19th. And that is Thanksgiving week, if you can believe it. So we won't meet that Wednesday, but we'll meet again the following Monday, assuming we need all these dates. Then the Wednesday and the next Monday if we need it. Typically, fall town meeting goes only 2 or 3 nights, so this shouldn't be a problem. We do need to get the stuff wrapped up by December 1st. Is that the goal?
That'd be the goal.
Because we need to finalize the tax rate with the Department of Revenue, and some of the budget amendments that we do in the fall affect that. So the proposal is to call the fall town meeting, the special town meeting in the fall for November 19th. Any thoughts about that? Oh, and I'll just mention, we did explore the idea of doing it in October instead, but really because it's already the middle of June and that sets the warrant deadlines for about 2 months prior, that would have them be in the middle of August, which just really is not practical in any way. So this is our best case scenario. This is just sort of a fluky thing to have the presidential election and the observance of Veterans Day happen when they're happening like this. But there we go. Questions or comments about starting on the 19th? Mr. Hayden.
That's three meetings before December 1st.
Yeah.
I know you know that.
Yeah. So.
What were we saying about a consent calendar?
Yeah, right. So that will inspire us. Ms. Brewer.
Associated with that, I would encourage the town manager in his discussions with staff and other town bodies to consider whether or not any of the things that they were thinking about doing at fall town meeting might be better served by a special town meeting in January or February of a one night sort of issue, rather than trying to push us, given we're starting this late. I mean, three or four sessions is not as big a deal but this late, not only because of the December 1st thing, I think just because of people's holiday lives associated with school breaks, et cetera, and which, you know, tend to extend even once their kids are long gone, given the academic focus of this community. So I'm very concerned about trying to have people during that time period, understanding that we have no choice at this point. But maybe that means that, you know, it's been a long time since we had a January town meeting, and everybody would prefer to have fewer town meetings, obviously. But if there's something that's just not quite ready, we don't necessarily have to wait till spring. Of course, we do have the option of doing a brief one in January or February as well.
Yep. Good point about other options.
This is already a special town meeting, so.
Right. All right. Any other thoughts about this? Ms. Stein, would you like to make the motion?
I move that the Select Board approve the fall 2012 town meeting dates, I guess, on November 19, 2012, with additional dates of November 22nd, November 28th, December 3rd, and December 5th, 2012, reserved.
Second.
Mr. Musanti?
I wasn't sure if you misspoke. November 26th,
yeah.
Not the 22nd.
I probably misspoke, but I do want to point out that I inserted the word dates after the first mention of fall town meeting, because I thought it belonged there.
So technically we scheduled it just the first date and we reserve the other ones. So we are setting the date for the 19th. Okay, was that seconded?
Second.
And further discussion, Ms. Brewer?
Can we include the word special in there? Because it's not a standard town meeting.
Sure.
Just in terms of the deadlines, et cetera, that might come up later, it's good to remind people that even though we do it every fall, it's not the same as the spring.
Indeed. Mr. Eaton.
Can we get some of those guys from public radio who push for the one-day drive to help us push for a one-day time?
That's right. That would be great. Okay. Further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
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 Aye. And that is unanimous. So shortly the calendar will be produced that has the deadlines for that, because again, those will come up very soon, but just so folks are paying attention, that's basically the early mid-September to be looking at for those deadlines, but that calendar will be published soon and be on the website. Ms. Brewer.
I know that they'll get that calendar together very quickly because we have excellent people working on that. But in the meantime, just because it is always hard to schedule a fall special town meeting around people's lives, I hope we'll put it out to TMCC right away that these are the dates, and then just watch the website for more information, because they'll eventually want to publish all that stuff again for us. But just to give everybody that's already in, especially since we have a bunch of new people, Lauren is familiar.
Excellent point. Thank you. All right. So now it is 6:47. So now we are going to, I'll just reiterate quickly what I said at the beginning of the meeting. For anyone who's tuning in for the public hearing on the liquor license application for Hess Express on West Street, we have had a request from the applicant for a continuation of this hearing. So what we do in order to accommodate that now is we will open the public hearing and then we will move to continue it to 6:45 on July 16th. That is our next meeting. So that is a proposal basically that is agreeable to the applicant Do select board members have any problems with that date and time? It's our next meeting, and we don't already have something scheduled for 6:45. So, all right. So then I am opening this public hearing at 6:48. And I will entertain a motion to continue the public hearing.
I so move.
Second.
And that will be continued to 6:45 on Monday, July 16th, 2012. Further discussion, Ms. Brewer.
And I don't think it needs to be part of the hearing, but I will blurt it out now and you'll figure out where it goes. That people know, I know that you have been, as people have been writing to us, you've been alerting them to the postponement, but to let people know, obviously they have a little more time if they really did want to say something, but that we have received comments that have been added to our packet subsequent. And also, if we could have a copy of the letter that you had to write on our behalf when we denied Cumberland Farms' application.
Oh, certainly.
I'd like to remind myself of what wording we used associated with that in terms of our rationale, just because we don't do these all that often.
Very well, absolutely. All right, further discussion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous. The hearing has been continued to July 16th.
You don't need a motion on that, even though it's on our sheet, do you?
We just did a motion.
We did it. Okay.
Yep.
So
we did
it. I did, but I wasn't sure if we needed precise wording.
Winged it a little bit, so that's fine.
Okay.
All right. We will do more untimed items then. We have the revised charge for the local historic district committee. Mr. Malloy was here to speak to us about this last week. A couple of select board members had little tiny things they wanted to change about that. A new draft has been provided. Does anybody have any questions or comments about the revised draft? Ms. Brewer.
Associated with the special municipal employee discussion, we had touched on the idea of whether or not, given that town council was already being asked for some information, if we would be able to touch base with them regarding this historic district commissions and their relationship to special municipal employee, since we want to make sure we all have a shared understanding of what that status is before we give it to another committee, which we were thinking we might want to do when we actually populate this committee.
I completely forgot to ask for that, for information related to local historic district committees and SME.
It's okay, I asked the town manager.
Oh, okay.
He forgot to.
So do we have information about that? Okay.
No.
So we will. So we don't have a motion. I thought we were going to have a motion too.
There
to give
a motion
it special,
for
the special municipal employee part of it, or just the establishing it. I thought it was going to be a joint motion.
It's to get the nominees, but not the charge.
To establish and solicit nominees.
Yeah, it's a double-barreled motion.
Yeah, and I think that we could add, without any difficulty, a separate motion. I mean, given it was clear that we were talking about this the last time, if we wanted to. And I think that we probably could just, we would go ahead and do it anyway. It's that we simply need to understand better, as we're soliciting people,
right,
what it is they're being asked to do and what some of their limitations are. But that doesn't mean that we really don't want to say, yes, we're giving them this status.
I'm sorry, the last part you said?
I think that we want to have this committee, amongst other committees, be at least one of the committees that has that status, even if we have some questions as to how much advantage that offers the individual members.
Okay, yes.
So I think we could add that as a separate motion without being outside the idea of, you know, posted 48 hours ahead of time, et cetera, because we clearly discussed it.
Well, it's on the agenda. It's just not
on
the motion sheet.
And
the motion sheet's not an official document.
Exactly.
What I was going to say is that, yes, that I my understanding is that we had thought last time that we were sort of pre-agreeing that we were going to grant the special municipal employee status because we thought it would help with the recruitment, that
right,
that would leave no doubt to people who are being approached to serve on the committee. But I apologize about the extra information, and we will get that also, because you're absolutely right. Having an opportunity to further clarify our understandings of that is always good. Okay, so so the motion is establishing it and basically by sort of a de facto approval of the charge, but we could make that more explicit in the motion if you want, or we could have an additional motion that approves the charge and grants it special municipal employee status, or however our motion people would like to proceed with that.
Well, I'm happy to add accept the charge after to establish. To establish the local historic district commission, accept the charge, and solicit nominees. That would be one way to go.
I think we're still talking about two different things. By saying establish, that is accepting the charge. That's what those words represent. And then we're talking about the SMU part of it. That's
okay.
This particular issue.
So, Ms. Brewer, you're saying you don't want to include accepting the charge?
I think establishing is accepting the charge.
Okay. And sometimes you want more, sometimes you want less. Yeah, you know, you just never know.
But I think you could include, I think it would be perfectly lovely to include it, and I personally think it would be lovely to have a separate SME motion.
That's fine. But I do think we need to have accept the charge in here.
Okay.
Because we are doing a lot of charge revisions, and I think
Good point.
So do you want the word establish as well?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right, Ms. Stein.
All right. I move that the Select Board, pursuant to the authority granted under Article 27 of the April 30th, 2012 annual town meeting, to establish and accept the charge and solicit nominees for a local historic district commission under the provisions of Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 40C.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
That's unanimous. And another motion.
All right. I move that the Select Board
grant
the local historic district commission, thank you, special municipal employee status.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstaining.
Sorry, aye.
Oh, thank you. So that's unanimous. Ms. Brewer.
Yes. The question I didn't think of, which is right in front of us, which was that we had talked a little bit about the fact that different communities do it different ways. In our particular case, we have a historic district commission we're setting up, and we know it's very much for one particular area of town. It was added to the sheet to say Dickinson Historic District Commission. It doesn't say that in our motion sheet, which I think is fine. I'm just wondering, we will think of it, and it's called this, but I actually think it's fine because we're doing it under Mass General Law, so I'm saying that discrepancy is not a problem.
Okay, then. Noted.
I think it works because it has clear. Dickinson instead of local.
All right. Anything else on that issue? Mr. Wald.
Depending on the practice, sometimes you have a commission that handles multiple districts and sometimes you have separate ones. So this giving it the generic name, I think, makes good sense.
Okay.
In case other districts are added, then people have options later.
So I think that Ms. Brewer's point, though, is that this one says in the charge
right.
that it's specific to the Dickinson district.
Right.
And I think that...
I just mean it's good to have a commission in place.
Okay. And so if we get another district, then we can either amend the charge or create another commission. How about that?
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. Good. Ms. Stein, did you
have
another comment?
Well, no, that's fine. That'll take care of it. I was hoping not to have the word district. I mean, Dickinson in the title so that the charge could have been more general and this would have been the first application. But we can fix it in the future.
If we ever get another historic district. Okay, this is what happens when you have half an hour to kill. Okay, good.
You're speaking
right
slowly.
Along. That's right. Proclamation in honor of Hope Church's 100th anniversary. I would like to thank Mr. Wald for bringing this to our attention. During the Memorial Day celebration, in fact, Mr. Wald thought of this and suggested, because this is their 100th anniversary and they are having a special service next Sunday, I believe is their centennial service, he suggested that this would be a nice thing for the Select Board to do, to make a proclamation honoring that important faith community and house of worship and historical building, something that the town has been involved with through helping with their restoration through Community Preservation Act funds, et cetera. And so he drafted a nice proclamation for us. Let's see. Mr. Wald, would you like to read that into the record?
I may have some typos here, in which case it's my fault. Minor things, okay. Whereas Hope Community Church, whose origins reach back to the middle of the 19th century, has played a significant role in the lives, struggles, and achievements of the African-American residents of Amherst, and whereas Hope Church, which at its inception benefited from the support of such distinguished national figures as W.E.B. Du Bois and Mary McLeod Bethune, has consistently advocated for and put into practice its commitment to civil rights in a diverse, pluralistic, and welcoming national and local community, and whereas, as one of three significant craftsman buildings in its neighborhood, Hope Church is a contributing structure in the Prospect Gaylord National Historic Register District, and whereas, the members of Hope Church, working in collaboration with the town of Amherst and the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, have secured resources and undertaken the labors necessary for the preservation of the building, thereby proving themselves to be good stewards of this historical resource, and whereas Hope Church continues to play a significant role in the spiritual and civic life of Amherst, now therefore be it resolved that the Select Board of the Town of Amherst thanks the members of Hope Church for their many contributions to the community, congratulates Hope Church on the occasion of its centennial, and urges other residents to celebrate this milestone in the history of the organization and our town.
Thank you. So moved. And seconded.
Seconded,
okay.
Yes.
Further discussion? Again, thank you. That was very well done and much appreciated. All in favor of
aye.
So proclaiming?
Aye.
I'll say aye. Ms. Brewer?
Yes. Is it on our motion sheet?
No.
Okay, good. Just making sure.
Okay.
Enthusiastically aye. Sorry.
That is unanimous. Thank you very much.
Beautifully written. Thank you.
All right. And we've got a few more minutes before our 7:15 item. So we have parking and street closure requests. We have several of them. These are all annual recurring events at this point. The Hampshire County Big Brothers Big Sisters Crafts on the Common event, July 14th. The the block party for the Blue Hills Road neighborhood on July 22nd, and the first day celebration. We're doing this one nice and early this year just so that they're nice and they can not worry that we've got it out of the way, but they might come in and talk to us about that when it draws nearer in August. So that is them. Ms. Stein, would you like to start those motions?
I move that the Select Board approve the reservation of 13 parking spaces on the east side of South Pleasant Street and 21 on the west side of Boltwood Avenue, both bordering the South Common, from 9 p.m. Friday, July 13th, 2012, to 9 a.m. Saturday, July 14th, 2012, and on Saturday, July 14th, 2012, from 4:30 p.m. to 7:30 p.m. for artisan unloading and cleanup, and to reserve the town hall parking lot from 6 a.m. to 8:30 a.m. Saturday, July 14, 2012, to provide for vendor registration for the Big Brothers Big Sisters Crafts Fair on the Common event.
Crafts on the Common is the title of it.
Ah, okay. Crafts on the Common event, excuse me.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
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 Aye. That's unanimous.
I move that the Select Board approve a street closing for Blue Hills Road on Saturday, July 21st, 2012, from 12 p.m. to 8 p.m., and a rain date of July 22nd, 2012, for the Blue Hills 11th annual block party.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
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 Aye. That's unanimous.
I move that the Select Board approve a street closing for that portion of Spring Street within the public parking lot from the intersection of South Pleasant Street to the intersection of Boltwood Avenue on Wednesday, August 29th, 2012, from 5:30 p.m. to 7 p.m. to ensure the safety of attendees for the Amherst Pelham Regional School District's First Day Celebration.
Second.
Further discussion, Ms. Brewer.
If we could just insert the word annual prior to First Day Celebration.
Very
it's becoming
well.
An annual event.
And further discussion. All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. That was unanimous. Ms. Brewer.
If we could add annual back to the Big Brothers Big Sisters annual crafts on the common as well. Just to
yep.
There again. Yep. We all know that, but you know, the wonderful people we have supporting us.
All right. More things we can get to here. Mr. Musanti.
There's one additional parking request, reservation request.
Thank you.
That's a handout
this
for you this evening.
Kind of here.
Yep. Got it.
A memorandum from me.
Mm-hmm.
D'Angelo Real Estate, the owner of the Tucker Taft building at 48 North Pleasant Street, is doing some building renovation work. And they need to reserve three metered spaces directly in front of that property on North Pleasant Street for one day only on Wednesday, June 20th. And in order to meet that deadline, there's a suggested motion at the bottom of that memorandum for you.
Thank you. Ms. Stein.
I move that the Select Board approve the reservation of three parking meters at 48 North Pleasant Street, Wednesday, June 20th, 2012, related to a construction project on the Tucker Taft building at a cost of $5 per meter for the one day.
Second.
Further discussion. All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. That is unanimous. Okay. We are just blowing through this stuff. Okay. We have a few other untimed items we can do here. Minutes. How about we do minutes? We had several sets of minutes in our packets. These are from town meeting, so they're all nice short minutes. Did folks have a chance to look at them and have any comments or questions about them?
I have very minor comments for May 7th. They're more in the nature of smoothing the English in a couple of places. Not important. I have nothing for May 9th, except there was a second copy of the May 7th minutes. Was there a change to that? That was on our table. Anybody?
We're not aware of a change.
I'm not aware of a change. I think it was just
okay.
an additional
right.
copy.
So then, because we got those in our packet, then May 9th, I have no changes. I have one change or a couple of changes for May 14th. I think we should say Amherst Knights of Columbus member Bill Hutchinson. I don't know if he was had another position, but it's sort of awkward not to at least include that. And Ms. Stein was actually the person speaking to the article on behalf of the board. And again, there are a couple of minor things.
Very well. Anybody else have?
That was on May 14th. Minor details on May 21st. And that's it. And June 1st, minor detail.
Okay, anybody have anything else they wanted to add? Little corrections. I had just on May 7th, it said that the representatives from Amherst Brewing were present. It should say were not present. And on the 9th and the 14th, just to add two people, one person each, one person per set of minutes to the list of participants. But that's all I can give those to okay. you.
Throw out the ones that have nothing.
Why don't you throw out the ones that have nothing?
Okay.
So
Ms.
Roussel doesn't have to figure that out.
I They're very trivial.
All right, and if you'd like to make that motion.
Okay, if I could find the motion sheet, which has disappeared. I move that the select board approve the minutes of May 7th, 2012, May 9th, 2012, May 14th, 2012, May 21st, 2012, and June 1st, 2012, as amended.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. That is unanimous. And I'll just note again how incredibly up to date we are on our minutes. Ms. Russello is doing a magnificent job in that. Much appreciated. Okay. And we still have a few more minutes. This is great. Okay. We did the minutes. How about committee appointments? Ms. Stein.
I move that the select board appoint Michael Hankey to the Design Review Board. Ellie Tampson? I'm not sure.
It's actually backwards. Should be Tampson Ely.
Oh.
What did I do?
It's correct on this sheet. Yeah. It's just wrong on the motion sheet. We know it's Tampson Ely. We know that's who's on the library trustees.
That's her first name?
Yep.
Okay. I will start again. I move that the select board approve Michael Hankey to the Design Review Board, Tamsin Eli, and Emily Lewis, representing the Jones Trustees on the Joint Capital Planning Committee, Kathleen Wood Mazalski to the Kanagasaki Sister City Committee, Stephen Schreiber as Amherst representative to the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission, Margaret Hankinson to the Public Arts Council, and Sandra Burgess as a registrar of voters, all with terms to expire June 30th, 2012.
Second.
15.
Says 15.
15th, excuse me. I'm puzzling because I think it's, these are renewals, I think all, but.
So it does say reappointments at the top. So we just change the first verb to reappoint rather than appoint.
I think that's right. That's what I was trying. I know for quite a few it is.
I just think it's strange that we're appointing people to JCPC. We don't usually do that.
It's early ahead, yeah.
Well, but we don't. Like, you just send somebody that's
right.
Not, yeah. That's not so at our discretion.
Why don't we
I don't think
take
we make
them
it
out?
Yeah.
One
why
is
don't
new
we
anyway. Ms. Right? Ely is new and Ms. Lewis has been there, so.
Right, so Ms. Ely wouldn't be a reappointment.
But it's a decision of the sending board.
Right. I think perhaps I would guess the office was just being helpful because we knew it was out of date. Because it went on our list, like when Diana and I go through the lists of who's on what, it's like, this is out of date. And so they probably found out who they were planning to send and didn't realize that we didn't necessarily need
to
do
Yeah, we don't usually do BCG and JCPC at this point.
So we'll just take
them
out.
So we're just taking them out. Not because they're not going to serve, but only because it's not our problem to
Right, exactly. Not now it's not our problem. Okay.
All right.
So anyway, then I think these are all reappointments.
Yes.
All right. Mr. Hayden, thank you. Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 And then for the next one, I move that the select board reappoint Mark Parent, Keith Langsdale, and Carolyn Holstein as associate members of the Zoning Board of Appeals with terms to expire June 30th, 2013.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. It's unanimous.
And
above that section, we have new appointments.
Okay. Yes, do you want to go ahead and do those now?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. I move that the select board appoint Rachel Mustin to the Amherst Cultural Council for a term to expire June 30th, 2015.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. That was cute. Mr. Wall poked Mr. Hayden to get his attention.
Yes. Okay.
For those who missed that.
Well,
that's right. I mean, we each have our roles to play, Aaron.
<That's right>.
Don't slip up. I move that the select board appoint Thomas Airgood as a full member of the Zoning Board of Appeals with a term to expire June 30th, 2015. And I should note he's moving up from the associate to the full, so it is new.
Second.
Further discussion. I will just note that this is the end of service for Barbara Ford, who has been on the ZBA for, I believe it's 9 years now and has served very well, and really appreciate her service and her serving as chair. So Thank you to Ms. Ford. Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. That's unanimous.
I move that the Select Board appoint Yuri Freiman as an associate member of the Zoning Board of Appeals with a term to expire June 30th, 2013.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. That's unanimous. And we still have a couple of minutes.
Before you run away.
Amazing. Mr. Hayden.
One thing I'd like to say, yes. I just like last week, and this bears being said, I think, every time, is I really appreciate all of those folks for stepping up to do the work, especially the two new names that are on the list. One of the new names is actually an old name who's coming back, but I appreciate all of them coming to help out.
Thank you, because we know that town services can be
an exciting and rewarding
thing to do. Yes, so yes, thank you to all of them and all of those that we appointed and reappointed last week. And is this the end, do we think, or will we still have some in July?
We have a couple more. Think we're getting close.
Okay.
We're getting close. I know on my list I have someone to thank that somehow I got to checking which form of letter and such, so we haven't quite pulled that off yet. I don't know.
Gotcha. Right. And the thank other.
You. I'm sorry, I was going to just say thank you both for your getting all of this process together. And this is, it's a lot to kind of get all of this organized and get it from where it was to bring it in front of us. So many thanks to both of you. Ms. Brewer.
Yeah, staff has been incredibly helpful with that because it's surprising how many little gaps we still see as we try and figure out all these different automated systems that are making our lives easier, but are still, you know, it doesn't really come to the front until you're trying to do a whole bunch of these at once. But we're really, really doing, getting more and more close to having this be really simple. The other thing that I'm supposed to be looking into, and frankly haven't done a thing about, is associated with the Amherst Community Television, also known as Amherst Media, Board of Directors. We've had Isaac Ben Ezra serving in that for a long time, which has been wonderful, but it's one of those things that's never been entirely clear to us what this role is, and the fact that it's in the bylaws for Amherst Community, but you know, what's the relationship? Are we supposed to be, you know, telling him stuff? Is he supposed to be telling us stuff? I mean, we just don't really know. And so when you have someone who's willing to serve all this time, which is great, and Isaac has his own show and it's terrific, but we just thought maybe we should have a better understanding of what that was before we worried about reappointing him. In the meantime, he obviously is continuing to do his wonderful service, and just one of those technicalities that we don't really know why we do it, so we thought we'd find out.
A number of things we do just because we do them, but we don't know. All right, so now it is 7:16, which is perfect timing for our 7:15 item, which is to consider a new committee charge for the Public Shade Tree Committee. And we have two members of Public Shade Tree Committee here this evening.
Have any sexy issues tonight, you know?
Yeah, we had a public hearing that got continued to the next time, so that's why we had a big gap. Yeah.
Okay, I'm Bob Irwin of the Shade Tree Committee, and I'm here tonight to try to cure a case of unplanned obsolescence. Our committee was formed about 40 years ago as an emergency subcommittee. Time the end light struck Amherst. Trees were falling everywhere. The charge and the mission statement and all that, everything that was written at that time is still on the books. And practice has changed a lot and probably should change some more. For example, it says that the Director of Conservation Commission shall approve the removal or planting of every tree in a public way. He hasn't done that for years. Town nursery is mentioned, tree nursery. That experiment was tried twice and failed, and it's unlikely to be tried again in the foreseeable future. And there's other out-of-date phrases and sentences. And of course, the tree warden has a much expanded domain compared to what did exist. Is he called the tree officer now?
No, he's still the tree warden.
He comes to our meetings, and we still make recommendations, but he doesn't have to listen to us if he doesn't want to. Well, we've gotten into education. Last week we had 2 busloads of 7th graders come to Groff Park and plant 70 trees. Many of them, I think, had never seen a shovel before, but the trees are all in the ground. Since Hope Crolius became chairman, we've done a lot more at on Arbor Day and Earth Day than used to be done. And it just seems to us that it's time for the committee to become a freestanding committee under you rather than a subcommittee under the old arrangement. Now, we did write a proposed charge. I think Hope passed that by you, didn't she?
Yes.
I don't think I have any more to say right now, but maybe you have some questions.
So thank you very much, Mr. Irwin. So this has long been, since the beginning, 40 years ago, has been a subcommittee of the Conservation Commission, and there's nothing subcommittee-like about them. This is really a fully-fledged committee, just one moment, and they do extraordinary work, and having them in sort of this alternative status didn't seem to make sense to them anymore. And so they went to the Conservation Commission and pled their case to be set free. And the Conservation Commission agreed that it really didn't make any sense to fall under their jurisdiction anymore. And they unanimously voted to recommend that this be an independent committee now under the Select Board's purview. And hence the recommendation has come to us. Is there something else you want to add?
I was going to add that we had been the Conservation Commission, but you did it for me.
Very good. So we have the proposed charge. And does anyone have any questions or comments about this? Mr. Wald?
A small one about wording, since we like to look at these details. On the top of page 2, the first paragraph, educational, in the second sentence it says school programs, comma, planning and pruning demonstration. Should that be planting or planning? Since we just mentioned tree planting.
Right, good point.
I believe you meant planting demonstrations.
Top of the second page?
Right, line 2, second to last
I think
word.
It's a typo. It says planning.
Well, we really want to expand.
Yes, yes, yes. It should be planting.
Planting, okay. Good, thank you. Ms. Stein.
I just want to say I spoke to Deborah today, and this is
which one?
Narrow it down.
I said Deborah. I
right.
followed the
I know
pattern.
Which one you mean.
Anyway, bottom line is work needs to be done to put this charge in the final format, and she did not have time to work with the committee and to draft it in the final format.
Okay.
So. For example, we can't say legally no more than 7 or fewer than 5 voting members. So that's just, you know, why Deborah needs to put this in a more traditional format.
Okay.
Okay. These issues that are described belong there, to do. The 3 functions, but it's just a matter of the format. So I just wanted to bring that out. Don't get too hung up on the wording.
Okay. Ms. Brewer?
I would recommend associated with that we go ahead with the motion that's on our motion sheet, mm-hmm. and then just knowing that we're going to see an actual generic, much more generic-looking right. charge later, which we will approve at that time. I also had the comment, so we need to come back to the special municipal employee status issue. But the other item that I'm sure you were thinking about associated with the 5 or 7 members, which I'm assuming is a recommendation from the current body as opposed to, and I'd like to hear a little bit more about whether they want 5 or 7 members and if they want to establish a quorum, because we certainly have plenty of committees with both those numbers. The other item is the proposed by the committee for approval by the select board. I'm assuming that's not saying that this committee would come to us with new members because that's not how we appoint members to committees, but I'm assuming that's just some reference to how they developed it up to this point. But that's something that would obviously come out because That's not how we do committee appointments.
We have assumed that we would nominate people and bring their names to you.
Yeah, that's not how we do committee appointments. But we would still, we would just ask people to go through the CAF process, and they would list members of the tree committee as references and say, you know, so-and-so asked me to apply, or here's why. And that's what people do all the time on their committee appointments. So that would take that into account.
Right. Okay, yeah, so you're free to recruit membership as, you know, as well as you can.
But you do it through the citizen activity form application process.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Okay, so you folks deal with our charges all the time. So if you would coordinate with these folks to kind of tweak this, but we can approve the concept of making them
absolutely
a standalone committee so that they can sort of go forth and recruit. Right. Mr. Messina?
Yeah, I was just going to make the point that the motion as drafted on the motion sheet spells out the substantive changes to the charge that they are seeking your endorsement of, and it has my strong recommendation. I think the formatting of the charge document, if you pass such a detailed motion, is really an administrative function.
Okay.
I don't think it needs another vote, because the substance of the change is what's in the motion before you tonight.
So in other words, we wouldn't have to see the charge again.
Oh, we would forward to you the updated charge in the new format. And if in fact there were any issues or questions, we would put it on a future agenda. Yeah.
Ms. Brewer?
That would be fine. And I do appreciate the way this was written for that very purpose, by having it. Sometimes we don't have that sort of intermediary mm-hmm. step in our minutes. And so I think this is actually really useful, showing how we're getting there.
Mm-hmm.
And we can, I think we can absolutely do the technical side of it. We want to decide the SME part of it before we leave this topic. But I also want to make sure that we're talking about 5 or 7 members and ensuring that there's not any type of talking about what quorum is. I'm assuming that will just be a standard 7-member committee, unless the motion says 7.
So the body has group has said either 5 or 7. So are you good with 7?
We're 7.
You need to come to the microphone if you want to speak, so the TV can hear you. And please identify yourself.
We're 7 now, but the problem that we've been having is that the one member, according to the old charge, was a liaison from the Conservation Commission, and we've been at 6, and we would really like the 7th member because we are short.
So you want 7 members. You just expanded to 7, if I'm not mistaken, not long ago.
Right.
Okay, so you want 7.
They want
okay.
7.
All right, good. So that's all we need to know for the motion, and you folks can work with them to, or however this is going to work,
except
to get the motion
SME
and to get the charge into final format. Okay, Ms. Stein.
Okay, I'm going to alter this. I'm going to drop 3 words. The words are "and provide advice," because that's the same thing as recommendations. Okay, so I move that the select board authorize a change in the charge of the Public Shade Tree Committee from a 7-member subcommittee of the Conservation Commission to a 7-member standalone committee appointed by the select board, duties to include recommendations and information to the tree warden on planting or removal of trees within the public way or on Town of Amherst property, and providing information and communicating the benefits of good tree cover to the general public, and working to restore a beautiful tree cover for the Town of Amherst.
Second.
Further discussion. Mr. Hayden.
Just a quick question. As I travel around the state, I see a lot of tree cities, USA. And I'm
tree
wondering.
Tree cities, well, Amherst is one.
And Amherst is one of them. I'm wondering.
25 years.
I know the Public Shade Tree Committee has had a number of guests come and speak with them.
Right.
I'm wondering how many other committees like this you know of in the state.
Oh, there's lots, dozens, but we're probably one of the strongest ones. There are some towns that just kind of leave it to somebody to do something about trees, but they don't do much.
Yeah, I remember that talk too.
Northampton is heavily dominated by lawyers, and they keep reading procedures to everyone who comes with any kind of request. Endless procedures, and they never do anything with the trees.
Ms. Crowley, did you want to make a comment?
Here.
Well, I just wanted to say thank you. And for considering this, and that I in the 5 years I've been doing this, I've come to the realization that actually Amherst is, we're not unique, but having a committee that is as involved is apparently, not the norm. We had a tree warden from a neighboring town up in Franklin County come and attend our meeting last Tuesday just to see how this is done, because he's feeling like, you know, he's the tree warden. How do you hold a hearing? How do you get people involved when neighbors want a tree down or they want it to stand? He's in the process of just starting to do that outreach, and he doesn't have a committee. He's all by himself, and I'm gathering that's kind of I don't know if it's the norm, but we're definitely through no virtue of our own, we just thought this is the way it was done and that we should be doing a lot more, and that's why we did this. So I think that answers your question.
Pittsfield has a very good arrangement. They have their own city arboretum.
They have lots of volunteers, and I may be vastly mistaken, but I don't know if they have a tree committee. You have lots of people with, like, friends of trees and lots of people doing volunteer things, whether they are in this role in relation to their tree warden. I wish Alan were here. I gather not as much as we are.
Thank you. Mr. Musanti.
Yeah, I just wanted to reiterate my strong support for this update to the Public Shade Tree Committee charge and extend my deep appreciation for all of the members of the committee and Hope Karolius, who I think is doing an excellent, excellent job as chair. Besides being a good idea on its own merits, it's also timely because, you know, as we celebrate our 25th year as a Tree City USA, we are about to embark with a near unanimous support of town meeting, just received of a very ambitious tree planting program to plant 2,000 trees over the next 3 years. We have a full-time tree warden certified arborist on staff, as opposed to being the volunteer tree warden, which I think is a best practice. And so it's an exciting time. I've heard from a lot of people about how great the trees used to be 40 years ago. Working with the committee and others, we've come up with a plan to do something about it. So it's an exciting time in the town, and looking forward to really getting started in earnest to improve our tree canopy, reduce pollution, et cetera, beautify our town over the next several years.
Thank you very much. Ms. Stein.
I would like to add one word to the charge. After the word include, put in providing, so it reads including duties to include providing recommendations and information. It was a little awkward without the word providing. Sorry about that.
No problem. Ms. Brewer.
Could we just double check while we're all here that we are, as opposed to what it says on this, we are going to go with Public Shade Tree Committee as the name of this, not Amherst Tree Committee. Public Shade Tree Committee.
Well, we hope to find people in the neighborhoods who will, you know, collect their neighbors and have a tree planting day, or they have some other connection with trees and private property. We don't have any jurisdiction, but we'd like to do some outreach. And
Ms. Brewer.
It might make more sense just to call us the tree committee or the town tree committee.
Thoughts?
If it's been known as the Public Shade Tree Committee, and I think it's deserved its good reputation that it's developed over the years of Public Shade Tree Committee, I don't think that sort of outreach is outside its purview. I mean, nothing the Public Shade Tree Committee does really has the force of law. So these seem like perfectly adequate outlines of what they can do and would not preclude you from doing that would be perfectly fine.
Right. And if we change your name, honestly, we're just going to say it wrong forever after.
So
just
like, gonna call
just like
anyway,
ACTV, so. You know? So
you're the publishing unless you really want.
I think you're stuck with the name.
There could be a place where there, let's say, there's an eroding bank and the trees are not planted for shade, they're planted to hold the soil.
That's so
other
true.
Hypothetical situations.
I don't feel strongly about this. What
but
was the select board like to
do? You get into the finer points of what's a tree and what's a bush.
Okay, not it's there. Getting late, so.
Not gonna go there.
I agree with Alyssa. I feel like it's a historical name, and for 25 years, you know. I remember reading the original statement by Nancy Eddy. And
well, foresters say the best time to plant a tree is 20 years ago.
Yeah, that's true.
All right, I think we're keeping the name then, so unless the select board does not seem to feel differently. Ms. Brewer.
All right, so we should
Excuse me 1 second. Hold on, Ms. Brewer.
I'm trying to clarify whether or not we finally voted on the finally words.
No, we haven't.
We haven't voted yet. We're in discussion.
We're going to have a separate motion about SME status. Thank
Correct.
You.
Are we ready to vote on this motion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. That's unanimous. Now Ms. Brewer wants another motion.
And now she wants to copy whatever it was Diana said earlier about the historic to grant the select board grant special municipal employee status to the Public Shade Tree Committee.
I so move.
Second.
Yeah, that thing.
Further discussion. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. That's unanimous. Thank you very much. Thank you for all your work on this and all your great work on our trees.
Thank you so much. Shade and otherwise. Can I add a PS here? If you have any influence at Amherst College, they have the rarest, most precious tree in town.
Talk to this guy after the meeting.
Down, you know.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Next up, it is 7:34, and my agenda is here.
You were worried.
Okay, vote to add retired teachers to town's health insurance plan.
Yes.
Are we all back with the agenda here? Okay. So last Wednesday, we held a joint public hearing with the Pelham Select Board and the Regional School Committee to consider the issue of the Insurance Advisory Committee's recommendation to switch retired teachers over from the state's General Group Insurance Commission, GIC, insurance plan to the town's healthcare trust fund. As all active employees are covered by, and our retirees are also covered by. So retired teachers were on this other plan, the Group Insurance Commission plan from the state. So we held a public hearing. As noted, there were probably about 100 people in attendance, 90 of whom were retired teachers, out of 228, I believe, retired teachers total. There are also other folks who are affected by this change, being surviving spouses and dependents, that sort of thing. So it was really a quite an excellent meeting and public hearing, and it is in rebroadcast on Amherst Media now. Ms. Logar, who is here to talk to us about this tonight, as well as folks from our insurance consultant and folks from Harvard Pilgrim and Blue Cross Blue Shield were there to answer lots of questions from folks. It was an extremely interesting evening. At the end of that meeting, all the teachers in attendance took a vote, and the vote is advisory to the Amherst Select Board for the Amherst Elementary School retirees, to the Regional School Committee for the regional retirees, and to the Pelham Select Board for the Pelham Elementary School retirees. So the vote that informs us tonight was about 3-1 in favor of switching to the town's plan. There is a memo that details this information along with a bunch of other information on the subject in our packet on the website for folks who are following along at home. And so that is where we are. So now to make this official, we need to vote on this recommendation. And I'll just note that in addition to the vote, the advisory vote that we had that night, we have the recommendation from the town manager and the unanimous recommendation from the Insurance Advisory Commission. And we have, as a select board, been paying a lot of attention to the question of GIC versus the town's being self-insured for a number of years now. Back when the healthcare trust fund was in a little bit less good shape, or considerably less good shape, there was a lot of talk about should we switch to the GIC, et cetera. Just a couple years ago, the legislature made that an easier thing for municipalities to do. And all throughout, we've been having the discussion about this, the discussion has always come back to, the fact is you get better benefits for less money on the municipal side, and by and large, less money for the insured recipients through the town's plan. So I'll just say that all of those things are pushing me to vote to approve the recommendation as presented to us. And Ms. Logar, is there anything you'd like to add?
I think you've said it very well. We have found, we've watched the GIC very closely. We've watched our group very closely. We have a terrific collaborative working relationship with our insurance advisory committee, which is made up of a retiree representative as well as representatives from each of the employee groups, whether they be union or non-union groups. So this is something that I believe that the three towns that are in, or the three entities, I should say, that are in the joint purchase agreement for the trust fund have carefully watched over the years, and we've utilized our insurance consultants as well as the feedback from our employees and our retirees to manage that.
Thank you. And I just want to take this opportunity to say that Ms. Logar was absolutely amazing the other night. There was no question that someone could throw at you, regardless of what their situation was, whether it was Medicaid eligible or ineligible, or whether their particular plan had to do with, you know, things that are out of the network or out of the country. I mean, it didn't matter how particular or broad the question was, she just answered it like that. It was totally amazing. So, and I think that gave folks a lot of confidence in how the town administers this, to have somebody be so expert and really knowing all of the details like that. So I thought that was really excellent. So thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
Ms. Brewer.
Thank you for saying that, because I wanted to follow up and also say that although clearly not all the attendees had read it, there was a frequently asked questions document that was incredibly elaborate, and she was so patient. She didn't say, it's on page 3, like I wanted to, and she explained it over and over in every way that they could possibly ask. So, and I know change is hard. I don't think this is any sort of formal disclosure. But nonetheless, my husband, therefore my family, is covered by GIC. And one of the things that I find interesting wearing my various hats is that we have had concerns in the past, obviously, with our healthcare trust fund here. And we did have a period where things were awkward and people had questions about that at the meeting, which was perfectly appropriate. It was perhaps not as brought out as I thought it should have been that GIC also, especially ironically, right after they suggested all the towns join it, ran into a bunch of problems with their underwriting when they suddenly had to then make draconian, what I consider to be draconian measures, which they suddenly started asking for upfront deductions and everything that they had not had before. And one of the things that I, not only is the fact that, you know, there was an issue with GIC, we had an issue, we both had our challenges. I feel incredibly confident about our town and the procedures we put into place to not have a problem like that. GIC don't have that confidence that they are prepared for that the next time around. And one of the other things that people pointed out is because we do have a feeling of more local involvement with our own trust fund. It's not, you know, this removed thing off in Boston where in theory you're represented at the table by somebody who represents thousands of people, but it's people that are being represented right here in town. So I think that all of that really feeds together, incredibly important, and it's a really amazing thing. I mean, when people first brought up the GIC thing, I was like, yep, let's just get rid of our thing. But it became very clear that that was not the way to go.
Thank you. Other comments? Ms. Stein?
I just want to reinforce the confidence that people got out of the fact that the meeting lasted till every last question was asked. So people didn't feel that felt that their concerns were really being addressed. And I think that's why the vote was like 3-1 for it.
Thank you. Other questions or comments? Mr. Hayden, and then Ms. Musanti.
Yeah, it's also sort of reinforcing the idea of the process. Now, it's pretty amazing that basically the people who were gonna be most affected by it were sort of most clearly heard. I mean, they had their chances to read and stand up and everything else. But it also occurs to me that these are people who worked with us, and in essence, their successors, who will become part of this plan, you know, in the future, are still to be recruited. And it seems to me like it's kind of a very good recruiting tool. Hey, look, you know, we will honor our commitments to you. And I know so many other places that have snatched these benefits away because they can't afford it for whatever reason.
Thank you. And I think that was a key point, too, that the town has a long history of treating the current employees and the retirees the same. So I think that was really meaningful to folks. Mr. Musante.
Yeah, I just wanted to reinforce the good words that have been said about process and to the work of staff. Ms. Slogar, as kind of our lead person on helping to administer employee benefits, and you saw that firsthand at the hearing, but also in all of the work going back many years now in the one-on-one counseling and questioning and answering that goes on with individual active and retired members. And it was clear, and we made the point, I hope, as clearly as we could at the hearing as well, that in any sort of transition, if the board and the regional school committee and the Pelham Select Board proceed, that there'll be open enrollment sessions and many additional opportunities for individual retirees to have their questions or just understand the process and how it affects them. And that's a commitment we have. And I agree that that's one of the strengths of our program, is to have a local contact through the town and through our public schools, that you can get answers to your questions and assist you in dealing with the health insurance companies. And I'll just make, for calendar reasons, the regional school committee is scheduled to take up this matter, as you are tonight, at their meeting next Tuesday, June 26th. And I don't have a confirmation as of now on the Pelham Select Board, but it was either this week or next week that they were planning to meet. So they're all planning to act before the end of June on this matter.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments about this before we get to the motion? Ms. Stein.
I move that the Select Board terminate acceptance of Chapter 32B, Section 11E, thereby transferring all eligible retired teachers and their dependents from the Commonwealth's GIC health and life insurance plans to the local Amherst-Pelham Health Claims Trust.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. That's unanimous. Thank you very much. All right. Now it is time for a town manager evaluation and goal setting process. We have three different things to do under this. The first one is the town manager's self-evaluation. This is something that the town manager does for us every year that helps to give us a sense of what his successes and challenges have been, and gives us just further information to help us as we proceed with our evaluations over the course of the summer. Mr. Musante did submit a memo to us, and that is on our web packet. And Mr. Musante, take it
away. Yes, I just wanted to, I hope, very briefly touch on this progress report, but also reminding people in the community that this entire report from me is posted on the town website as part of the June 18th Select Board meeting packet, and we'll stay up there as past reports have. And I wasn't intending to go through each and every goal, but certainly, you know, if there are questions on the progress report of any of those, happy to try to answer those for you. I do want to highlight a couple of things, though, from the self-evaluation summary at the beginning portion of the memorandum. First, I think it's been a very rewarding year, but also a challenging year. And every year is challenging in this position, but this was a particularly challenging year for me on a personal level as well as a professional level. I had a slip and fall accident, as you know, last September, and had an injury that I was recuperating from, and I was forced to miss about 6 or 7 weeks of work in September and October, and then have returned then on a part-time basis, and over a period of weeks ramped up back to full-time and beyond. And that was, a challenge for me, but I wanted to note again, as I did in my January progress report, that the staff of the town of Amherst at all levels continued, I think, their excellent work and really stepped up in a major way in my absence, taking the ball and doing what needed to be done. I wanted to particularly thank Dave Zomek, who, as you know, served as acting town manager during that period. And we continued our ability to work well, and his ability to triage issues large and small and bring some matters to my attention, but not many others that he was able to do very, very effectively. And I also wanted to particularly thank Deborah Roussel, the assistant to the town manager in my office, who, has been doing excellent work right along, but during this period in particular, really played a really good leadership role. Her continued support of the select board and the other particular challenges related to my absence. So I just wanted to thank them again publicly for that. I did also list what I think are key highlights and accomplishments over the last 12 months. Make the point again that I think there's a lot of positive momentum in the town of Amherst, and I think we are poised to build on some of the successes we've had over the past couple of years, and this year in particular, and really am looking forward to continuing our work. Gone through an extensive list, I'm going to highlight some of them. I think in terms of the delivery of town services, ultimately we're as good as the people who work with us and for us, and I was particularly pleased this year to be able to fill two very, very important positions that had vacancies due to retirements. I've been able to recruit what I believe is a really outstanding new building commissioner, Rob Mora, who started in April, and really refocusing the inspection services department, how the daily work is structured, the use of technology in the field, the responsiveness and clarity to applicants about what's expected as early in the process as possible. I think we're off to a good start on that. And then most recently, I've announced the appointment of Deborah Radway, to be known as Deb, for those Deborah watchers in the town of Amherst. As Human Resources Director, she'll be starting on July 16th. She brings 23 years of public and private sector human resources experience, and I think is going to be a real top-flight professional presence overseeing our human resources role and the ongoing work as Human Rights Director and working with the Human Rights Commission and others on those things. So I'm proud of that. We talked since last October about a no-drama year for budget development, and by and large, it was a no-drama year. We've done a lot of hard work, painful choices over the last couple of years. We had some projections back in the fall that were refined as we came forward. We ultimately came up with a balanced budget plan that was recommended to town meeting. That town meeting has adopted as recommended. It's essentially a level services budget and a real stabilizing budget. And I think in and of itself, that doesn't sound all that exciting, but given the period we've been through with this protracted recession and the work we've done, really proud of that outcome. And that's partially responsible for our continued strong bond rating, AA bond rating, which was reaffirmed in March. That's a very strong bond rating, and for the first time in our bond rating review, when we issued bonds back in March, the rating agency hinted at some possible next steps that would help us be considered for the first time, to my knowledge, in the future, to become a AAA rated community, which is the highest possible bond rating, and that would further help us to reduce borrowing costs and allow us to spend more of our capital dollars on the actual projects and debt service and not as much on interest payments. So pleased about that. You mentioned earlier tonight the creation of the Dickinson Historic District, which was a big deal and was a great collaboration on the part of town staff, Historic Commission and Study Committee and community members and leadership from people like Jim Wall to help make it happen. So very proud of that. Was particularly proud in the budget process to introduce a proposal with Superintendent Garrick to really strengthen an after-school program partnership with our public schools in the town at each of our three elementary schools, and we are working actively on that to retain the best of what we have and build upon it as we get into the fall. We've talked about the pool. We came up with a plan to fix the pool, fund it, and open it. And while we're delayed a couple of days, that pool's been closed for a couple of summers now, and we now have a plan not just to reopen it, but to have the pool be better than it's ever been through a grant, mostly state-funded grant. Other highlights, Select Board's endorsement of the petition to create a downtown business improvement district that occurred last October. That is now coming to life this spring. I serve on the board of directors as the town representative, and the Amherst College and UMass are also participating members, which I think is one of the unique characteristics of this bid, but also a strength, because it's not just the people power that helps, but also some financial support and other in-kind support. And we've hired a new executive director, and I think we're off to the races on that. Really exciting on beautification, programming, special events, marketing, et cetera. All things green. I think there's many different initiatives we can point to. I can point to the tree proposal to plant 2,000 trees, adopted with near unanimous support of town meeting. The application for green community status has been submitted, and we're expecting word any day now, literally, on whether we've been approved, and we're very optimistic we will be. You know, there's ongoing work on our solar project and fuel efficient vehicle policy. There's a number of things. Let's see, another initiative, sewer extension master plan, was another long-standing need that was, the needs assessment was updated with the help of our consulting engineers at CDM. We had a staff recommendation to you last fall. The board endorsed an update to the sewer extension master plan and how to pay for it. And we went to the fall town meeting last November and secured town meeting support for a bond issue of $4.2 million to extend sewers into the Wildflower Drive and Harkness Road areas over the next 2 years. So that's a major step forward in serving the community. So I'll stop there and
thank you very much. That's an excellent memo, and the detail is extremely helpful. We've been trying to improve and build on this process of the goal setting and the evaluation over a couple of years, and to have all these different formal steps to it, I think, is extremely helpful. So for you to detail this for us is going to remind us of a whole bunch of things that we might have otherwise forgotten about. It will inspire us to be reminded of things that perhaps you've forgotten about, and it's all extremely helpful as just another piece of the evaluation process. Does anybody have any questions or comments for Mr. Musanti about his memo? Okay. As you noted, just a reminder to folks that this is on the town website. Soon, at the beginning of July, early July, there's going to be a public notice. It'll be a news item on the website seeking public comment on the town manager's evaluation as well. And so this could be a document that is useful for folks, anyone looking to comment, as just a reminder about all the many things that have happened this past year under Mr. Musanti's leadership. So, excellent. All right. Thank you very much. I appreciate all the work that you put into that. Okay. Next up, we have review and approve documents. Make any necessary timeline revisions. Okay. So, let's see. The first one is, I'll just say, was there anything about the timeline anybody thought needed to be changed that we wanted to deal with? We talked about the timeline last week, but just in case you thought of anything. Okay. If you think of anything, let me know. The other documents... let me make sure I've got the right things going on here. We spent a fair amount of time last time talking about a couple different documents. One of them is the evaluation form that we use, the select board uses. And I hope that I captured all of the things that we wanted to do. So let me just go through, see if I can make this work, and then go through the various revisions that I made to that. Does that work? Yes. Okay. So, first of all, I'll note that this is a form that we inherited years ago, and it has been revised and updated many times, and ultimately one of the major things we decided to do last week was take out one of the categories, which went from being six categories that we would judge from down to five. That just pretty much exploded the old document. So I had to start fresh. So this is good. We now, going forward, have like a new era document. So that will be much better for anyone in the future. Okay, that's not important. Anyway, so this evaluation form did take out the outstanding part that we talked about, it making commendable the top category, because we decided that there was not significant difference between those two. We talked last time about getting rid of what had been the number three question on there because it was repetitive. In doing that, it occurred to me that we were missing one. So what's on there right now, actually I moved down, I changed the order of them. Anyway, what's on there as number two is now new. I added that and rearranged what had been the top three because we got rid of number three. So I added prepares budget in conformance with the select board's budget policy guidelines memo. There's a lot of talk on here about the budget and the fact that that we are doing this other process that's associated with that, and that he is going along with that seemed an important thing to note. And I specifically worded it as budget policy guidelines memo as opposed to budget policy guidelines, just in case this is something that stays for the future and in case other select boards maybe are not quite as formal as we are with presenting such a form, that it didn't just say budget policy guidelines, which unless it is formally presented as a memo, you couldn't necessarily know that there were any formally approved guidelines. So that was my thinking behind that. Are people good with having that in there? Okay. Let's see. What else did I do here? We had another one that we removed. Oh, okay. We wanted to add what's now number eight. We talked about last time adding a reference to town meeting and how town meeting gets prepared for, because in this whole document, strangely, there's no reference to town meeting, and that seemed important. So taking the cue from our discussion last time, I said presents to town meeting with thorough preparation and clear communication for your consideration. I got rid of, there was another one that the numbers are just slightly different this time because once you start moving things around, but there was one that had been number 15 last time that we didn't like. It had the word selects in it, selects, leads, and directs. We got rid of the selects, so that has been gotten rid of. And I think that... pretty sure that that was all of the things that I changed and all of the things that we noted. Don't get too hung up on the formatting, the pagination of this, because Word really does not like to do this kind of dramatic formatting, and everything will change once we start putting our comments in the right-hand thing, right? So I decided not to make it too beautiful to deal with that part this time. So I think that's everything about this form. Does anybody have any questions or comments, or did I miss anything or not capture anything?
For what it's worth, Stein. I thought it read better.
Okay.
Okay.
Good.
So I was happier with it. I didn't stumble over that redundancy, for example.
Yeah, I think there was one other thing that was redundant. Oh, just one that we removed entirely that had to do with the long-range planning. That's correct. We just removed entirely because we had such a detailed long-range planning goal. So, yeah, those are now all of the things that we did to it. Okay, so do we think we're pretty good with this form to use for this year? We'll tweak it again next year. Okay, excellent. Thank you. All right, so then the next form. I can make all my electronics work here. The next form that we talked about was the staff questionnaire. And let me find mine. Here we go. Okay, so similarly, we got rid of the outstanding category to make it match ours also. This one, okay, we had a couple of comments on this. The comments last week were that some of these were phrased as, we called them you questions versus like your supervisor, and people kind of tripped over that. So Ms. Stein sent me a couple of revisions to deal with that, which I think captured the same thing we were talking about last time. And I think that pertains to number 5 and number 6. It, before it said something like keeps you or your supervisor informed, whatever. So I got rid of the supervisor part, and I might have added the word relevant, I'm not sure. And the next one, it was similarly, it said includes you or your supervisor, whatever, in decision making significantly impacts your department, and I put as appropriate. So I think those are the only changes to that part. The other thing I did was I changed the order. We had originally started with what's number 4 now, but that seemed like a funny one to start with. And we even talked about, you know, whether it's the best question or not. The more I thought about it, I still like it as a question, but I didn't like it in the top spot. So I moved it down to 4 and moved everything else up. That is all the changes that I made to the questions themselves. At the very bottom, I put, please use the back of this form or attach a separate sheet for any additional comments. And that is all. And so we'll talk about the cover memo after that. But any thoughts about how this is revised? Ms. Brewer.
Two things. One is, it is really funny how when you just reorder things, the first question is so much more the way we've done it, the way you rearranged it, is such an important question, one that we've really struggled with over the years, and it's terrific to have it right up front like that. So thank you very much for doing that. I am not going to argue this to death, which I'm sure will thrill everyone, but on 6 and 8, it now says as or when appropriate. I think that's unnecessarily hedging. I think that everything that's on here is could arguably have the concept of appropriate applied to it. I think we don't want to make this more complicated than it needs to be. If you don't think that if you don't think the town manager ever delegates authority and you don't have a problem with that, I mean I just don't see where adding when appropriate or as appropriate is necessary in either of those cases. I hadn't thought about it before until we redid these things without the supervisor part, which I think was a good idea to take that out. And I think we should just leave them out. They're much cleaner that way, and people can write interpretations as they choose.
That's true, because we've talked about this when we do the goals too, that you take the opposite. You say, well, does he do it inappropriately? Like, okay, I
don't
have a problem.
He delegates all his authority, and it's a stupid idea.
What? Okay, yeah. Mr. Wald, you have a comment?
I guess we're not in time-wasting mode anymore, so maybe I should be quiet.
I take Ms. Brewer's point, and it's a good one. I just thought maybe, especially for delegating authority, it could be important because there it made more sense to me than the other categories, because you want the town manager to be a leader but not to be a micromanager. But I'd have no strong feeling either way. As long as we all agree on the sense of what's being asked for, I think it doesn't make any difference.
I guess I sort of like it in number 8 also a little bit better than number 6. You're right. It's not like as opposed to inappropriately, which would be silly, but it just does seem a little like, to Mr. Wald's point, that he doesn't delegate all of his authority or something, which would be inappropriate. I don't know. Mr. Hayden.
Okay.
Uh-oh.
When needed. I mean, we're asking somebody, you know, to make an assessment, not an appropriateness, that's someplace else, but where they feel it's been necessary.
Yes.
I'm trying to think of you know, what is the answer we're going to solicit with the question. And delegates' authority, well, okay, but I'm not sure I care as much about that as to whether they think it's been done. And appropriate is a slippery and not a very good word, not a very appropriate word.
It's an inappropriate word.
But maybe where they consider it necessary.
Mr. Musanti, how would you like people to consider your...
Here's your chance. Write your own question.
This is not a cop-out. I have no problem whatsoever with the deletion of as appropriate in number 6, because I think all parties understand that that doesn't mean that every decision that gets made is subject to approval or feedback. You know, there's ways to solicit that input that are more efficient than others. Number 8, I'm okay with when appropriate or when necessary. I think it gets us to the same place.
Okay. So I think we're probably not liking number 6 because that's new, because I added that as part of the revision. So it doesn't sit well with us because it's new and inappropriate. So we'll strike that one. Because this, we are now splitting hairs. Ms. Brewer, are you fine with us leaving it in number 8?
Yeah.
Okay. Everybody else fine?
Unless you want to change it to necessary.
I don't know. Okay. Anything else then about these? It's inappropriate and unnecessary.
It's necessary to be appropriate.
Anything else about this form then? All right, so we're going to consider this form approved. Okay, then next up is the staff cover memo questionnaire, which Ms. Stein has submitted some revisions to. And I will just tell you that the only thing I did to this was, let me just look at it first. Oops, that was your version. Okay, I added what is the third paragraph that says, additionally, if you have questions or if you have suggestions for how to make the questions more relevant or useful to you, we would very much appreciate that information as well. Please feel free to add those, blah, blah, blah. So that was the only thing that was different from what went out last year. So Ms. Stein has some suggestions. Would you like to speak to your revisions?
I'd like to explain what I did. I wanted the suggestion that the staff could make changes to this format to stand out more than I thought it did. So I combined what Stephanie had into the first paragraph, And then instead of saying additionally, I made a whole second paragraph that stands alone that says, if you have suggestions for how to make the questions more relevant or useful to you, we would very much appreciate that information as well. The only difference in her wording on that paragraph is that I dropped additionally. I wanted it to be on its own. I want people to pay attention to it. In order to fit things into the first paragraph, I tweaked them a little bit. So instead of her wording, it says, the select board is conducting its annual performance evaluation of the town manager. That's the same. As part of that effort, we would greatly appreciate your feedback and enclose a questionnaire for that purpose. And that's in italics just because that's a new way of doing it. If you wish to expand on your answers, feel free to use the back of the form or attach a separate sheet. And then we go to the second paragraph. There is incidentally two periods on that first paragraph. I don't know why. If you have suggestions and so on. So the idea was simply to bring the forward the concept that they could make suggestions about how to improve our questionnaire. And there may be even, you know, other ways to do that. But I thought making it as a separate second paragraph gave it more emphasis.
Thank you. Let me just read it over quickly. Yeah, I'm fine with that. Is everybody fine with that? Reads well, Mr. Hayden?
I am fine with it as well. I'm wondering, and I'm going to wonder out loud, I know we're not in time-wasting mode anymore, but still, if we create a sentence that explains why we're asking, I mean, it's you know, more useful. Well, how? I mean, I think that the reason we're asking the question, and I think I'd like us to say the reason that we're asking this question is that we're trying to make a more effective evaluation. And, you know, we have questions and criteria that we are considering, and we're wondering what their questions and criteria might be. Now, I'm sure there's a better way of putting that. But it's a little bit open-ended to say useful to you to, you know, but why, how?
Okay, maybe if we put in kind of a comma phrase that said something like, or other questions, and issues that you think should be.
Well, I mean, more relevant and useful to you, but also effective in helping us make the evaluation.
Or in future questionnaires, something, you know, saying this week.
Yeah, and you know, the intention is to incorporate them into future questionaires and evaluations. But
okay, to help sort us of improve
give it,
future.
It's
okay.
Not just sort of. Okay. Useful, define it, nail it down a little bit, give them something to think about, push against.
Okay, I think I can work with that. So
thank you.
Some words like that, okay. Yeah, I'll run it by you, Aaron, and see if it captures what you think.
I know I'm supposed to write this up and send it to you.
Right? Oh, we forgive you, okay.
Anyway.
All right, anything else then about this stuff? Okay, so then we will proceed with the timeline and with these documents as presented, and that kicks off that part of the evaluation process. Okay, so then the next part is our first goals discussion for FY13, and we started doing this a couple of years ago, and this, I think we found that it works very well, that to be working in parallel on the goals for next year when we're giving really detailed consideration to how the goals and the evaluation went for last year. So I don't know if this document ended up in your packet or not. I fear not. So I made copies and put them on your desk tonight. And this is the one that looks like this.
13 discussion.
Yeah. Okay. So in keeping with the format that has worked well for us the last couple of years, the first discussion is just about the FY12 goals and whether we want to keep them, delete them, or revise them for FY13. So when we talk in July, we'll be talking about brand new goal ideas, things that aren't on here now. But at this point, we're just talking about the FY12 goals and how they fare for next year. So, and I'll remind us that this is, as we do with all of these things, this has gone through exhaustive processes to get them to this point. And in fact, last year we really improved them significantly in wording and formatting, which is not to say we can't continue to do that, but I'm just reminding you that we really did make these pretty darn good last year. So the first question is about budget issues. Anybody have anything they would want to change? So I think that this is clearly a standing goal, one that we need to have each year. So does it need to be revised at all? Okay, if you change your mind, we'll come back. Number two is this one we broke out. This had been part of a community relations goal previously, but we broke it out because it really is so critically important, and that's about the town manager's relationships with UMass and the other colleges. Again, something that I think clearly needs to stay, so the question is, does it need to be revised at all? Everyone's shaking their head. That's good. So if I'm going too fast, then tell me and we'll slow down. Okay, number three is the community engagement goal, about generally reaching out to the community to inform them and to gather information from them about town issues. Again, a standing goal, I think. Ms. Brewer.
Aside from taking the italics off of B, although maybe we should put it in bold this year, it's definitely a standing 3B.
Oh.
For whatever reason, is italicized.
Gotcha.
Which the town manager carefully carried over into his self-evaluation, because he wasn't about to change a single character of what we wrote, because he knows how we are. But I think that's a very important standard thing to keep there, too. It may not be something we get a lot into this year, but I think we've done a wonderful job getting these to this point, and so, as you indicated earlier, but I think that it stands perfectly.
Thank you. All right, number four, high staff morale. This has been an important one, maintaining this. We changed a lot of things last year to make them be more like maintenance as opposed to achieve. So I think this is one of those. And I think that one looks good and should stay. Any revisions? Okay, number five has been on there for a long time, but this is actually one of those goals that you can check off the list. So this is the one about assessing the town's human resources needs and capabilities. I think that there's been long concern about the state of the town's human resources abilities and infrastructure, and now we've had a change there. We have Ms. Radway coming in a month. I would be inclined to just leave this off entirely and assume that there's going to be improvement there, but that's not what I'm hearing from other folks. So Ms.
Okay.
Stein and then Ms. Brewer.
Not even close. I agree with Alyssa. I really think it's important, since we're going to have a change to a whole new person and system, that we determine in the future how well we are recruiting, hiring, retaining, and supporting town staff. I mean, it's not just the top of the heap, it's how things are going underneath in the rest of the substructure.
So to still get an assessment to us about the status of that, which new eyes will provide a lot of value.
I wouldn't take it off.
Okay. Ms. Brewer?
I think it stands with exactly all the words it has in it right now.
Okay.
Because all those things are going to happen once she starts.
Right.
And then they'll be working on that together. And then maybe after the first year, we would want to tweak it to reflect something particular they brought to us as the next step, rather than leaving it broad like this. but it's both broad and detailed in ways that we don't have any of the answers to yet. We just are putting a lot of, we're assuming that everything's, the sun's going to shine and everything's going to be perfect, but we still need to know all those things moving forward.
Okay. Yeah, so I guess my sense was not wanting to start this person off with the sense that this is a, you know, a problem to be solved or whatever. But no, I completely hear what you're saying. And I want to emphasize that the reason that number four and number five have been really important to the Select Board for years and years now is because staff is what the town is. You know, when we talk about our budget, you know, that $70 million or whatever, I mean, that is staff. Staff is how the money gets spent and invested. They are the resource that makes the town run. So their morale is critical, and how their internal human resources situation is existing for them and working for them has been very important to us. So that's why we've made these priorities. Mr. Hayden.
I have to say that reading this brings back lots of memories, sort of remembering commas and words being fought over. I'm wondering, I think I understand, you know, your initial comment on number five. You know, I'm wondering if it's because we think of assessment maybe in a less than a positive way. And I mean, it isn't. It's a completely neutral, requesting kind of, it should be completely, I mean, this is not a you know, 2,700 page report, but just something to keep us aware of, you know, how 82% of our budget is being spent.
So are you suggesting a change to the word assessment, or you're
no,
just
change in our thinking about the word assessment.
Yeah, okay, thank you. Ms. Stein.
And goals doesn't imply that things are rotten in Denmark.
Right.
It's, you know, some of these goals we want to keep on having forever, like high staff morale.
Oh, sure.
So, you know, I don't think we're implying anything. We just want to continue the process.
Good enough. Okay. Anybody want to make any further revisions or comments then on number five? Then number six, this is the big communication with the Select Board goal, keeping us informed about everything. This is really kind of all about kind of the relationship between and the difference between the roles of the Select Board and Town Manager, and trying to make sure that we're all on the same page. And any issues with number six? They're laughing. I want to know what they're saying. Okay, any comments on number six? Good enough. All right, number seven, detailed assessment of town-owned buildings regarding their current use. So this was on here for a little while now. We haven't quite
gotten
it.
And we'll continue to be on there for a little while. Now.
Yeah, so we may or may not receive more information in the meantime, such that by the end of this process we might remove it, but at this point we're thinking it needs to stay. Ms. Burr.
I can't imagine that, I mean, despite the wonderful information that's in the self-evaluation, it's still, I think there will still need to be some discussion about how we move forward after we get the report and what his next thoughts are about it. So I think it stays for FY13 period.
So, and obviously we're not, just because we're talking about them and thinking we're approving them tonight, we might, as we get through the process, both in our thinking through the evaluation and the things that will happen between now and the end
sure.
of August, that could change. So if need
yeah.
be, we can revisit that
right.
in August. Okay, number eight, the green goal, our wonderful green goal. That was a new one. I think it was last year. I think this is the second year. This is a good one. And again, something that you want to kind of keep because
right.
it's about being very clear about the expectation and having that out there.
Absolutely.
Okay, so no revisions, just keep as is. Okay, number nine is about a staffing plan. So my inclination is that we need to keep it and that we need to talk more about what our expectation is from this. So I believe I had initiated this last year to talk about having gone through multiple years of budget cuts and layoffs and attrition, you know, general workforce reduction, you kind of lose sight when you're trying to stop the bleeding of the terrible budget cuts that we were having of what is the optimal need, the right size for the various departments. And a lot of things have changed in the meantime, so you wouldn't necessarily just reset the departments to where they were, you know, pick some date in the past, because there you realize a lot of efficiencies, et cetera, as you go along. So I'm thinking what we were looking for, what I think we were talking about then, was to have something that will help to guide us when there is new money or, you know, new priorities or whatever, so that we can plan. I mean, again, staff being the big resource, the big investment, what is it that we're looking to do in the fire department? What is it that we're looking to do in the police department? And that gives us a framework for talking about the budget each year and for talking specifically at town meeting and responding to various questions about staffing needs or challenges or whatever with a plan, you know, says, yeah, here's kind of our general goal. So either we're not entirely clear on that or you're not entirely in agreement with that. So from what I just said, you want to comment on that at all?
I want to go 9 for 9. We've begun to lay out staffing and other needs in our long-term objectives, structuring of my budget recommendations to you department by department. And like goal number 5 about human resources department, the coming fiscal year is going to be about completing a number of those specific analyses for staffing, and in particular public safety. So with or without inclusion onto this list, there's going to be a lot of work done by me and staff on this issue for the reasons that Ms. O'Keefe said about budget guidelines and planning.
So I think that we're talking about then an end result, which is something that we can read and look at that says, you know, these are the departments, these are the needs or whatever. You know, Public Works is one of them that we talked about, the issue that was part of the budget discussion this year about how folks there had been, unfortunately, in the past, it kind of moved over to project-based money, and that's kind of impacted Mr. Mooring's ability to shift staff around and do work as needed. That kind of thing would work well in this kind of a plan, you know, so we would all know what we're striving for in a perfect world, and the steps that we need to take to get to that. Ms. Stein.
It's funny you mentioned Public Works, because that's the one, through serving on as liaison for the Personnel Board, I got to see the people in that in Public Works and exactly how one relates to the other. For most departments, I have no idea. And I was just wondering, just throwing this out as an idea, if we could go through department by department with that kind of structure, who reports to whom and where are the holes. It would give me insights to the functioning of the police department, the fire department, and other departments' finances. I don't even know what they would look like. I have no clue, whereas I have a better understanding of Public Works. I think it would be a good framework for us to consider where the holes are.
Thank you. I'll note that some departments have been including an org chart like that in their budget. So in our big budget binder, we have some nice org charts for some of the departments, but not all of them. And so, you know, consistency is always good. And to know that, all right, you've got this resource for all the different departments. So I second that notion also. I'm going to go over here and then Ms. Brewer.
Just briefly, maybe a good part of sort of civic community building information too, because you often hear people, especially at town meeting, and especially with new elected people, saying, you know, why do we need so many policemen in a town this size? Or why is our planning department this size, whereas the one next door is a different size? And I think it's helpful for all concerned if we have a rationale that we can point to. Then we could be debating something concrete, not just speculating. And then, of course, the common, the final point there about including post-employment benefits just came up with the teachers. So obviously, that's another reason to keep it. We're budgeting for the future, the long term, and not just for right now. So it's a model. It's not a recipe that one follows to the...
Right. It's a framework. And I appreciate very much the point you just made about being able to talk about these things in a context, you know, when town meeting, that's kind of your classic thing. Oh, why do we have so many planners or whatever? Because then you can have a policy discussion about it, you know? I mean, so if you're looking to put X amount of resources to this department versus that, then we can really compare and contrast, and the community gets to weigh in on whether the framework as laid out really matches their values and priorities. So, okay, good. So did we want to revise that at all, or we're just good with it as is? Ms. Brewer, oh, I'm sorry, I meant to call on you.
No problem. I think, again, just trying to clarify what I believe this goal to be representing beyond what's already been said, is that it could include, as part of an ongoing process, the org chart type things that Ms. Stein was talking about. It is incredibly important to, you know, the more information we put out there for town meeting. I think that what I'm trying to say is that we are not asking for a whole new report that doesn't exist per se, in that most of the information in this report exists, or at least the bones of it certainly do, within the big budget book, within the objectives that are in there. But rather than just leaving them in there associated with the budget in any particular year, or they just get recopied and pasted like they did for a few years, that we're looking for something that's somewhere between blue sky visioning and the specific analysis of public safety. I mean, in addition to saying, you know, given where we are with firefighters and new negotiations, et cetera, and 24-hour schedules, so this year, the next year, 5 years, in addition to that, just in general, what kind of fire department do we want to have? In general, what do we wish Public Works was doing? We think it needs a tree department. We had this big issue where people retired, blah, blah, blah. Do we have a parks department? You know, what do we think works based on all your past experiences, based on what you've seen as things that we could do better here, based on all the feedback that you've been getting about different things, so that it's kind of like our master plan for the town, so we know, oh, this is working toward the goal of getting us to this point associated with the way our planning, and, you know, we've done so many things already, planning, conservation, inspections pulled together, IT, you know, what more or less do we think IT should be doing in terms of interaction with the schools, for example? Is there a goal associated around that that we can kind of have, although it's a separate document, a bunch of the information and it already exists. It's just a matter of pulling it together in a slightly different way so we can say how things fit together, without just having to remember that there's a separate isolated report on some particular issue at some particular point in time.
Right, an easy reference document. And I will just emphasize that another theme, since all of us have been on the Select Board together and doing all these various goals, is the Select Board has always been looking to emphasize and find ways to have the manager take the most advantage of getting feedback from the staff about stuff, whether it's budget issues or staffing issues or whatever. And so so this specifically says, through consultation with each department staff, on number 4, and it talks about high staff morale priority in A, it's talking about engaging and soliciting feedback from staff. That's always been the Select Board in recent time, anyway, I don't want to speak for past Select Boards, but that's been sort of a continuing theme, again, about valuing the staff. These are the folks on the front line. They know best how we do what we do as a town and where improvements might be needed or suggestions could be made. Just the Select Board is always looking to emphasize that, and that was true with all these goals as well. Okay, if I'm not mistaken, we didn't make any changes to that document. Is that right?
That is correct.
Beauty. Awesome. Okay, good. Next, we have, so that's the end of this, the evaluation and goal stuff for today, unless anybody has any other issues that they wanted to talk about. Refer to your timeline for information about next time, but specifically we'll be talking about new goals, new goal ideas as far as the goal discussion go. All right, town manager's report, Mr. Musanti.
Thank you. Several items I want to bring to your attention. First, I wanted to talk briefly about some planning we're doing at the staff level. Last year at this time, we applied for the competitive park grant, capital P-A-R-C grant from the Executive Office of Environmental Affairs and Energy. And we were awarded the grant for rehabilitating the War Memorial Pool. At the time we submitted that grant, I made clear to Commissioner Sullivan that it is my intention for the town of Amherst to be regular applicants. And so we've done some brainstorming at the staff level. The deadline for this year's grant application is fast approaching on July 12th. And I wanted to bring to the board's attention that we're focusing on what we think is a doable project. The grant program has been revised. Last year there was a maximum grant award of $500,000 and there's a local match. That has been revised downward this year. There's a maximum of $400,000. We've coalesced at the staff level around submitting a grant related to rehabilitating and improving what we call the North Common, which is the portion of the downtown town common directly in front of Town Hall, between Town Hall and South Pleasant Street. That is a beautiful space, as you know. Last updated in terms of landscaping, et cetera, when Eisenhower was president, 1958. So since that time, there's been some deterioration in the tree canopy that Alan Snow is beginning to address. We have a lot of erosion. We have the footpaths, the fountain, sidewalks that have deteriorated. It's tired, and it's a beautiful historic space that we think has great potential to be rehabilitated. We are looking at there's a design build option when you submit for a grant, which would make this a 2-year project. There'd be a small amount of money, I think 30 to 50,000 allocated if we were successful in the first year for a design phase. And we have staff and graduate student and other ideas on how to improve that space going back to the 1980s that we'd want to update, get the benefit. But I can envision the landscaping, the walkways, improving the sidewalks, possibly expanding the sidewalks on the perimeter of even as many as all sides of the space. Funds permitting, we will explore rehabilitating what we call the Main Street parking lot, the public parking spaces directly in front of Town Hall, that parking lot. I think the basic layout is fine. It's just needs paving and all that kind of thing. So we're going to look at that, and we can anticipate submitting something by the July 12th deadline.
Questions or comments from Select Board? So the common is part of our jurisdiction, so that's particularly important to get our feedback on this, and grants are to be brought before us also, so it's a double win here for this agenda item. So I think that this is just a fantastic idea and a really critical thing to move forward. This is one of those assets that if you don't take care of it, then look what happens. And it's something that is very visible to the community all the time. The community really cares about it, and really it just makes us look bad, and it makes us sad to have it in such disrepair. So to improve an existing asset and take care of the deferred maintenance and now make it better than it was in Eisenhower's time, I think is wonderful. So I really appreciate you and staff pursuing that. Mr. Hayden?
Yeah, I would add to all of that how frequently that space is used by people exercising their right of free speech and assembly and events.
Yeah, it's a critical space.
Okay,
go forth with our blessing. Thank you.
And we will somehow make the deadline, July 12th. Main Street, another 2012 paving plan changes. It's really, I want to give a brief update on our road construction season that's underway. First, about our Main Street project, you know that there were funds allocated in the most recent community development block grant to do handicapped accessible related barrier removal improvements from the stretch of Main Street, lower Main Street, from the intersection of North East Street down by the Fort River School, all the way up the hill through the newly named historic district, past the Emily Dickinson Museum to the corner of Churchill Street in the downtown. There would be sidewalk improvements on both sides of the street, handicapped curb cuts where appropriate, and ADA compliant crosswalks. And then as part of that, the road improvement itself, paving, but also the installation of bike lanes on both sides at the appropriate width, and improvements for bus pull-offs on that stretch. And there's a detailed plan that's been developed and vetted with the various groups. That's the good news. The bad news is that the bids came in earlier this month, and they did exceed the CDBG money that's been allocated so far. We're in the range of $250,000 to $300,000 short to do the entire project. We are actively working at the staff level to identify Chapter 90 funds, which is our annual allocation of state gas tax money that comes back to the communities for road maintenance, road paving work. I think there's a way to do that. The only hitch on that is that the upcoming year's Chapter 90 money is part of the transportation bond bill that's currently being discussed in the state legislature. There's a $200 million allocation for local roads contained in both the House and Senate versions of the transportation bond bill. So that gives us some assurance about the ultimate dollar amount we're going to get. But there are other differences unrelated to that in the bond bill that are being reconciled in a conference committee at the state level. And so the weeks are ticking by, and it's important for us, for the legislature, to complete that work ASAP on the transportation bond bill so we can have access to those funds in order to award the contract to our contractor that has submitted the apparent low bid. Depending on the timing of that, that may force us to phase this project, and there are different segments. So one option, and then we're gonna kind of wait and see over the next few weeks, the resolution in the legislature. But one option is to not cancel, but delay the portion of the work that's the closest to the downtown from roughly Triangle Street to Churchill Street until such time we have legal access to the new allocation of Chapter 90. So that affects the timing. We know this the work will be done over two construction seasons regardless, but it may delay the awarding of that portion of the contract for a period of time. So I just wanted you and the wider community to be aware of that. We talk about improving our roads, but also at the same time making our community more walkable, pedestrian-friendly, bicycle-friendly, and Main Street is our main street. So we are working aggressively to do the entire project. I don't want to spend $500,000 or $600,000 and then not be happy with the result when we could have spent $700,000 or $750,000 and get to the result that that's been laid out in the master plan and elsewhere.
Questions or comments about Main Street? Ms. Brewer?
I think it's important to somehow succinctly express that in writing to both DAAC and the CDBG Advisory Committee, just so that they know, you know, and say, you know, detailed questions can be answered, you know, referred to the town manager's office, but just so that they know when they hear something about this, also if they have particularly strong feelings about a particular area, maybe, you know, if we had a choice as to which area to prioritize, not just for the obvious construction-related reasons, they may have a very strong opinion on it one way or another as to which particular area got first. And you know, so just that later they don't say, well, of all the things they could have done, it would have been better to do X. It may well be that there is nothing like that, but they would like the opportunity. Okay. I know that's important to them.
Sure.
Good, thank you.
I wanted to also provide an update on other road construction updates for the related to the same reason I just alluded to about the timing and amount of our upcoming year's Chapter 90 road paving allocation from the state. We are proceeding with our paving list that we've described previously in the spring, but I wanted to update you on a couple streets in particular. First, reassure those who are wondering, Cherry Lane will be resurfaced. And I know some may argue with the term resurfacing. It will be surfaced from East Pleasant Street to a little beyond the traffic circle, about a couple hundred yards into Cherry Lane. And you can kind of tell where the old pavement meets the new pavement just prior to Weaver Circle. That will be done. There's some sewer line repair work that's being done first, and then the Cherry Lane work will, the paving part of that will follow. So just reassuring folks. Lincoln Avenue, that is on our paving list to be a resurfacing, as well as the installation of speed humps. Again, given the timing of the and the amount of the Chapter 90 award from which it would be funded, and the needs on Main Street that I've identified. My plan is to proceed with, there's some sewer line repair work that's also needed on Lincoln Avenue that needs to be done so that we're not in this situation that we're digging up a newly repaired street. We're replacing, in some cases, clay sewer lines and things like that that just, you know, have served us more than well over the many, many decades. That will be done. My intention this season is to proceed with the milling step, so grinding down the street to eliminate the moonscape, and that'll be the base coat, and the manholes and catch basins and things like that will be lowered so they're flush with the milled layer. That will be substantially smoother than the current situation, but it won't be complete. Next season, 2013, we plan to complete the repaving of Lincoln Avenue and the installation of the speed humps that have proven to be so successful on Sunset and McClellan. And the objective and promise and commitment remains the same. It's a timing issue based upon the dollars. And so there's going to be a substantial improvement to Lincoln Avenue this season, but with the entire job being completed in 2013. Those are the key ones.
A couple questions on that. So Could you tell us what the final status was on the paving, the 4.5 million that we borrowed for paving last year? Because I thought that we were going to spend and pave half of that's worth last year, and then spend and pave the second half this year, and that Lincoln Ave was part of that 4.5 million, and that it was on the list for this year. So, but now my understanding is that all the 4.5 million got paved, got spent last year. Is that because things cost more, or did we do more miles of road than we expected?
Both. Both the actual pricing and the ability of our winning bidder, Warner Brothers, and the superhuman efforts of the DPW engineering and other staff to monitor, an unprecedented amount of paving in this town in one season. There are punch list items related to things like landscaping that DPW is working to complete, but the paving portion was essentially done last in calendar 11.
So if Lincoln was part of the plan for this year, it was part of last year's plan to be paved and paid for this year, and it wasn't paved, it's not going to be paved this year, how come that money for its paving isn't still out there? Like, what got paved instead of Lincoln that we spent all that money?
I don't have the specific answer to that, but I can get it for you.
Okay, because I'm curious about, am I the only one who thought this was sort of a half and half thing?
Yeah.
I thought it was half last year and half this year, so to have spent it all, but to still have some of these big ticket ones that I thought were to be included for this year, I just like clarification on that.
Yeah, well, that was the original plan, but there was an ability to utilize all of the funds in one season.
Okay. Yeah, so if we could know what got paved with that money, that would be great.
Sure.
Ms. Brewer?
Yeah, absolutely, because, I mean, one would have thought otherwise, that one would utilize all that money in one season for the things that were going to be done in two seasons.
Right.
And so if we chose different priorities based on, there must have been a reason we chose something other than Lincoln, rather than just that we like to get hate mail. So it would be really...
Can I just say, in all seriousness,
and
I don't... claim to control what people's opinions are out there.
Right.
We're doing something about the streets.
We are.
And while we can take some pride in the first $5 million we've spent, there's still $15 million to go. And 2 years ago, we had $22 million to go. So we've made some serious progress, but there's a ways to go. And I think we have a path to get there, and then calendar 13 also promises to be a big year where at the state legislative level and gubernatorial level, we talk in detail in a serious way about transportation infrastructure and regional transit funding solutions that are real and substantive that will help us get us where we need to be to address this backlog.
As part of what the money got spent on and got paved last year, could we also get an update on what the priorities are going forward? Triangle Street is another one of those critical roads that people are always using and always asking, how could it possibly still be that bad? Pine Street, people are always asking about. So we've got the situation with the grant. We're again applying for a grant. Again, this involves sewer work, and you want to make sure you sequence all this stuff correctly. But there is the grant involved. So that would be a really terrific report to have kind of an update on what's already happened and what the priority list looks like going forward. Ms. Brewer?
Yeah, and absolutely. And it doesn't have to be complicated. I mean, whatever the last thing was, if you want to just write on it and say, check, 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 did all these, and, parenthesis, this one's over here, is fine. It doesn't have to be fancy. We just, so we're all on the same page.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments about paving? All right, moving along.
Okay. Next, I'm really pleased to announce that Chancellor Holub, Superintendent Garrick, and I have executed a one-year extension of our strategic partnership agreement with the University of Massachusetts. We have a, what is now, we're approaching the end of a five-year agreement negotiated by my predecessor back in 2007 that provided a more formalized and detailed structure of the various relationships, services, and otherwise we have with the university. And that was due to expire. My discussions with the chancellor and others at the university this spring was to pursue a short-term extension because of the leadership transition underway at the university, and the university was amenable to that. Also, I find a lot of value in the fact that we have an agreement, and that's what I've executed now, knowing full well that we'll be working with the incoming chancellor on an extension over the coming year, and we'll be continuing to collaborate on things like water conservation, water reuse, and other initiatives that we're in discussions with the university. So that's an important agreement. There's a funding formula in there for things like ambulance services provided to calls to the university campus, police services, memorandum of understanding, and some other things. It's a valuable agreement that both parties want to continue.
Thank you. And to get that done as a one-year extension during this transition makes the most sense. I really appreciate that UMass was amenable to that also. That's an excellent way to handle that. Ms. Brewer?
Yeah, that's terrific. Thank you. Because, that was one of the things that was a little bit worrisome. What's going to happen?
Yes.
I'm also just adding a reminder that I'm sure was on your list anyway, because it's in the original agreement. But I would like some characterization to us at a future meeting as you're going into the next set of this discussion about what we're doing about the students in non-taxable housing now that Mark's Meadow has been determined to be no longer necessary to house our elementary school students, because we do know that a substantial, usually in the neighborhood of at least 50 students, are in non-taxable housing. Many of them are low and moderate income students, and we just want to know what sort of arrangement we might have that might reflect that in some fashion.
And just so folks understand who don't pay as much attention to this as Ms. Brewer does, so there's it was referenced in the original agreement that there was no kind of exchange of money related to the non-taxable housing, because Mark's Meadow, which was on the UMass campus, was considered to be sort of it was considered to even out. They were providing us like the building for the elementary school and so their students, so it all sort of evened out. But now the building isn't there anymore, so it's not quite even anymore, so it does need to be addressed. Thank you.
Next, War Memorial Pool update. I've distributed in your packet tonight, or the updates to your packet. We are working actively with our pool contractor to complete the rehabilitation of the pool to allow it to reopen this summer. We do have to delay slightly the reopening date from Saturday, June 23rd to the following Saturday, June 30th. The liner installation, the completion of the decking, the fencing, the bathhouse repairs are essentially done. We need a few more days. We've lost some time this spring, and we're hopeful, really up until the last couple of days, that even with weather-related delays this spring, impacting construction, that we are still optimistic about meeting a June 23rd opening. We're going to have to have that slip by a few days, one more week to June 30th, and we'll have an opening for community use on Saturday, June 30th. Our opening ceremony, celebration, whatever you want to call it, that we've had a committee planning is also postponed, and we will reschedule that at a date to be determined. I'm sure it'll be sometime over the course of the summer, hopefully the early summer, and we'll proceed that. There was some programming scheduled through Leisure Services in the War Memorial Pool for the last week of June. We have worked with the Amherst Public Schools, and we'll have access to the middle school pool for that programming during the week of June 23rd. So LSSC and the schools are working on that, and all the gory details on that, and participants will be notified, et cetera, et cetera.
Thank you. Questions or comments about the pool? Ms. Brewer.
Yeah, I appreciate that you told us right up front about the swim lessons being moved to the middle school, and yep. Fortunately, that is not far away, and so it should not cause a substantial inconvenience to parents to have to be in a different location. Will Mill River still open on schedule on Saturday, the 23rd?
Yes.
Based on everything else we know? Good. And the other question I have that I don't expect you to answer tonight is, but in the future, is what we could have done differently. I'm not accepting the 20 weather-related days as being the only answer to this. I think there must be something we might have tweaked earlier in the process. And I'd like to talk about that in a general sense at some point in the future, because this is just something that we are taking a lot of heat for, having known that it was going to be true for a long time. And, you know, things do go wrong, obviously, all the time.
But can I just say, and I'm not trying to be defensive, but I'm approached this whole endeavor starting from a pool that was broken and closed and not available for anybody's use or enjoyment. We've come up with a plan to make the pool better than it's ever been, and it's reopening in a matter of days, a handful of days beyond the original target. There are a number of factors, the most significant one being weather, and even that we were optimistic that would still not prevent us from opening at the original date. But this is a tremendous project. I know we all agree with that. There's tremendous excitement in the community and support for it. But I'm happy to talk with you further offline about there's a lot of factors, and we are where we are, and I don't have any regrets.
So, not to belabor it, but I'd like to talk a little bit more about what the factors were, because people are disappointed by this, and granted, we can all wait a week, like it's not the end of the world, but the sense that we've had a year to be ready for this, why was it coming down to being ready at the last minute? How come it hasn't been already ready? Why was the...
Let me give you another thing, and this is meant not as any criticism whatsoever with the Commonwealth and their... support for giving us a grant in the first place. I have no authority to spend grant money until those grants are formally executed on the part of the Commonwealth and they're in hand. And so the timing of those coming back to the town directly impacted our notice to proceed, and by extension, the ordering of equipment, et cetera, for the actual work. Despite all that, we were confident on the schedule. And then that was compounded by some bad luck with the weather. That, you know, you need some completely dry days as opposed to mostly dry days to get some portion of this work done. So, there are some factors that are almost exclusively beyond the town's control, but the bottom line is the project is happening and it's getting done, and we're a matter of days away.
So that's an important point for people to know and understand. So knowing that town meeting voted the money with or without the grant, is the fact that had we spent our money earlier, which the town had authorized, then it couldn't be reimbursed by the grant?
That is exactly right. And we're talking $208,000 maximum. Knowing that we have this award, knowing until really the last couple of days that it was quite possible to meet the original opening day, even by those delays that were caused, I didn't want to leave some or all of the $208,000 on the table and have the tax dollars that are spent locally to pay for this be any higher than than what they needed to be. So that was a judgment call that I made.
I hope it opens next week. Looking forward to it. Ms. Brewer.
And I would certainly argue that town meeting would be very happy with the judgment call you made in that case. I think it's just a matter of next time around, when we get a park grant associated with something, it's probably worth explaining a couple of these details that did cause us a bit of delay here, saying, you know, I know on the surface of it, we said town meeting would pay for it one way or another, but guess what? You didn't really want to pay for it if you had the park grant coming, and some of it's just outside of our control. And that might seem really obvious to you, but that's not as obvious to the community that's just all excited about the pool opening up. So that's the kind of thing I meant
and
for future.
Sure, reference. I get it. And I hope this conversation helps in that regard.
I think it does
and,
a lot.
You know, with some or all of the $200,000 coming out of the town treasury as opposed to a state grant,
absolutely
worth it on this, you know, delay of 7 days.
Okay. All right. Anything else on the pool?
That's it.
Moving along. Anything recent and upcoming?
No, I think the two key hearing dates this week on the Hawthorne affordable housing portion of that project and the zoning subcommittee citizen forum for zoning priority setting were the two key dates that Mr. Wald mentioned.
Thank you. Okay, member reports. Ms. Brewer wants to talk to us about state open meeting law and comment period on various issues.
Yeah, you don't want me to talk about the leisure services meeting that's going to have a field trip to the pool on Wednesday?
That'll be
anyway.
After.
So, open meeting law. Well, this is one of those things that wouldn't have been nice if I'd written up something ahead of time. To remind us where we're at with this, you have three pieces of paper that are in the packet. The top one's probably intentional violation. I want to talk about the other two first. Both of these, they're slightly different from each other. One is a notice of emergency regulation. That's the one that says remote participation issued May 24th, 2012. That's followed by this pretty printout that they made us in the office because they're so helpful, because they don't issue everything as PDFs at the Attorney General's website, that talks about remote participation, which I have talked to you about before during an earlier comment period. We've looked at in general, you know, what the different restrictions were that they were setting up for it. It wasn't clear in the regulations they were putting forward based on remote participation exactly who got to decide what. Would it be up to, and of course we know in our town it's a select board that gets to decide, but then could individual bodies then decide to accept it or not? Could they decide to adopt different regulations for the use of it associated with geographic distance and child care needs and that sort of thing? You know, exactly who got to decide and how blanket of a decision it was, to summarize. What's changed associated with this emergency regulation is that, and they have it in the frequently asked questions, is basically what they've said is that, again, in our case, the select board is the adopting authority. We can authorize the practice. You can't say it's good for some public bodies in your town and not for others. It's either good for everybody or it's not. But the public bodies themselves can say, we don't want to do it. We've been given the so we could say as a select board, all 54 committees or whatever can do this, but they could say, nah, we don't want to do it. And that would be the one decision they could make. They could not, however, decide that they liked geographic distance, but they didn't like another part of the reasoning. They can't do that. They can only do the one straightforward thing. The one of the little tweaks to it that I thought was interesting that they made clear in the frequently asked questions is that the adopting authority being us is that we could say that if any equipment purchase is necessary, that such money, were it to be spent, could only be spent on, say, the select board doing remote participation and not any other body if we wanted to, which seemed really random to me. But that's what they say you can do. So you can say, oh, you can all do it, but we're not going to give you any money to do it. So that is one thing you can do. What you can't do, however, is you can't go against state or federal law. And what that means in this particular case is that because the Attorney General's office has written the thing saying geographic distance is a thing, we can't say geographic distance isn't a thing. However, we can say, and we at this level, not at, you know, the different individual body level, can say that 30 miles is an unreasonable distance, or 60 miles is an unreasonable distance, or out of the continental United States is an unreasonable distance. But then that applies to everybody that chooses to use this. But we can't just say geographic distance is a stupid idea and we don't like it because the Attorney General has decided it is one of the ideas. So the purpose of bringing this to your attention now is because, one, we have to talk more about remote participation later this summer, which is going to be over before we know it, and two, because there is a comment period available again, which you can see at the bottom of the sheet, submitted by July 17th, which is the day after our next meeting. Personally, when it comes to this particular issue, I'm not sure I have any additional comments. I mean, I think the choice they made was unfortunate, but that's what they chose to do. And the fact that they're clarifying now what they meant by all of that, I don't really have any further comments about that. But if any of you do or find this very fascinating, feel free to either write that on your own or let me know, and we'll try and come up with something for the select board to say. But at least it's nice that since they're doing some stuff, they came up with a fact for it. Which kind of leads us to the other piece, which is the intentional violation. Now, this issue is something we've also talked about before. It was something back in January, as I recall. I was quickly typing when we got to MMA in January to put in a last minute comment associated with this. What is an intentional violation? Is it that I, as a select board liaison, am sitting at a committee meeting and I hear somebody say they want to have an executive session, and I say, you can't have an executive session for that. You don't know what you're talking about. And they go ahead and do it anyway. Or is an intentional violation, you know, actually setting out to, you know, have a serial meeting on purpose where they got people going in and out of the doors like they've had in some city councils, but of course no one's ever done here. So what exactly did intentional violation mean? So I did send in some comments. They didn't address them entirely, although I did notice in their minutes that it did come up, what I'd said, so it did actually matter that we sent those in, and very few people send in comments, big surprise, and almost no one goes to their hearings, yet another big surprise. So they do have a definition here of intentional violation, which you'll see is much longer now. In my opinion, I would like to send, or I definitely do intend to send a comment, and I will have it ready for the 18th for you to see that, and again, they're having the hearing at the same time. Very efficient on their part. Next day. I still am not convinced with what they're trying to accomplish, and like I said, I read their minutes hoping it would become clearer to me, but is what they mean by informed or advised. So when they say that you were informed or advised by a court of competent jurisdiction or the Attorney General, does that mean there was a complaint, something was written to you, Bob Smith, that said don't do this again? Or was there something written to your town 3 years ago that said Board of Health, don't do this again? Or did something happen in Holland and Massachusetts and say you should all know about that? Or even something that's updated on the AGO website. For example, this lovely fact, which makes things much clearer than you would ever guess from the way the actual, they have no RSS feed because it's so sad. They don't have enough resources to do that. So we have no way of knowing when they put new information on their website, and they've admitted that. We don't know how to tell people we need a different way of doing it. We don't have any budget for that, blah, blah. MMA tells us sometimes they're actually more on it than they used to be, because of me complaining. But still, how are we supposed to know if something has happened? And when they put up new advisory opinions, that's great, but you know, how much time does every municipality, every individual person have to read those? Is it something we can just assume someone will send us a quarterly, you know, update of? So there has to be a little bit more information, in my opinion, in whether it's in the regulation itself or in a frequently asked questions associated with the regulation as to what informed or advised means, because I don't want to be checking the website every 5 minutes to see if something's changed versus what we're going to do next week, just because there's a lot of different odd things that people do out there, as we've seen from past opinions, and a lot don't seem to apply to our particular situation, but I wouldn't want us to be blamed for something that happened in the Freetown Soils Board or something. because we didn't know about it.
Right. So what accounts for you should have known?
Right. Yes. So, exactly. Yeah,
so that makes
sense. That sounds good on the surface, but what does right. it mean?
Okay.
So I will have something ready on that for the 18th.
16th, I think.
16th, right. I'm looking at the 18th at the top of my page. Yeah, 16th.
I'm sure you all join me in being glad that Ms. Brewer is handling this on our behalf instead of us right now.
Yes, I know.
Thank you very much for paying attention to that kind of thing. All right, liaison and representative reports. Ms. Brewer, would you like to talk about LSSC Commission now?
So they were going to go to the pool to say, look, it's going to be so nice on Saturday. But obviously that's not going to happen. And in fact, their meeting is also occurring. The 5 o'clock, there's the 5 o'clock meeting on Wednesday night, and then their meeting was going to start at 6, and so there's some conflict there. So their agenda, as usual, is up on the website. Other meetings, Housing Sheltering Committee is going to be meeting next week. CDBG is going to be meeting next week. And so everything's perking along, also associated with the regional, I'm not even going to pretend I remember the acronym right now. Regional School District Planning Committees are now a Regional School District Planning Board. Another open meeting law we're trying to sort out with that is how easily we can post meetings of subcommittees that include people from each of the four towns at all the four towns when some of the towns only have like a clerk who works 2 hours a week. So there seem to be some ways of dealing with this, and Debbie Westmoreland's been super helpful associated with the schools. Yet another Deb, yes, that's why I had to include her on the list. And so those meetings get posted on our website as well as the schools. There'll be a more visible website associated with this. But basically what's going to be happening associated with the four towns working together is the next step is to come up with an RFP to figure out where we want to hire some consultants to do various educational governance and financial analyses for us, which we have no specific source of funds for right now, but we're hoping that after this budget process is over in the legislature, there might in fact be another grant program available to us that we will be more likely to rise to the top of, whereas the last time around, we weren't this far in the process because even though each town had said they were going to work on it, they didn't say they were going to work together. So apparently that might make a difference as to the next round of grants. So probably nothing exciting happening there anytime in the meantime, except for the fact that our finance committee chair, Andy Steinberg, very kindly agreed to be the chair of herding cats from four different towns, which is really pretty impressive. So he's getting hugely into this whole issue and is very, very involved in all of it. So if Andy seems more freaked out than usual, it's because he's trying to do all this too.
Preoccupied.
He is, he's doing an amazing job thus far keeping us all together, and it's not an easy task. But we're hoping the whole process only lasts about 2 years, so we'll see.
Wow. Thank you. Okay, Ms. Stein.
I went to the last Agricultural Commission meeting, which unfortunately didn't have a quorum, but Pete Westover was there, and he pointed out that there are, I think, 5 fields awaiting farmers that Amherst College owns. I hadn't known that, and I thought that was fascinating. So if people are interested, they should contact Amherst College. In farming these, they should contact Amherst College. A lot of my committees are dormant, so Stephanie and I went to the Zoning Board of Appeals administrative meeting.
You need some excitement.
That's right. I mean, you know, life is so quiet, huh? Not. Anyway, it was, I can only stay for part of it, during which time I presented a possible solution for a complaint that I have heard about 2 years ago. The town attorney said quite appropriately that according to Chapter 40A, they could not rotate associate members onto full panels. They had to only serve on a panel of 3 full members in the case of one of the members having a bona fide absence due to, say, health or conflict of interest or vacancy. This meant that the associates get to serve about 1/5 of the time roughly, that the Fulls do, and there was unhappiness about that. And I was suggesting that the one way around it would be to move to what would take a town meeting bylaw to effect, that is a 5-member panel of Fulls with only 2 associates, that there is an imbalance to have more associates than there are full members. This would be the very, very beginning suggestion of a thought to move in that direction. There is no guarantee that that's something the Zoning Board of Appeals would like to do, but it is one way to handle that discrepancy between the number of associates and the number of Fulls. Stephanie, however, stayed for longer than I did because I went down to the Agricultural Commission that was meeting at the same time.
Right, so I can just expand a little bit on that. So it was a really good conversation, great presentation by Ms. Stein to the ZBA about that 5-member panel concept. To be able to get those folks' feedback, just their thoughts off the top of their head about the pros and cons of something like that is really valuable. And as Ms. Stein said, that will all kind of inform this process going forward of much more research that will happen on that. So that was good. The rest of the meeting was really excellent. ZBA, I think I was a couple years on the select board before I even really understood what the ZBA did, but they're very different from us and other committees in that, as we're talking about, they have 7 members, but they really only meet as panels for public hearings 3 at a time. So these administrative meetings are something that happen very infrequently, but they are their opportunity to sit around and talk about what they're doing and how they can do it better, the way select board can kind of do it at any meeting and most boards can do. But because they're always meeting as this public hearing panel, that doesn't happen for them. So it was really terrific to be able to sit there and watch them talking about how to improve their processes, how to try and standardize some of the conditions that they deal with. Like, they were talking a lot about duplexes and conversions in neighborhoods, and every situation is very different, so you can't really have a standard set of conditions that you'd apply, but they talked about the benefit of gathering a bunch of the conditions that they have applied in the past that they could use as a reference list, because every panel is differently comprised, as Ms. Stein is saying, so you don't want to depend on somebody remembering whatever or having been exposed to whatever. Now they're going to be able to look at this list and say, okay, let's see, was this a good one? Would this one apply in this condition? Okay, this one doesn't apply now, this one doesn't apply. Oh, but this is a good one, glad we remembered this, just to have as another resource at their disposal. So they're talking about all kinds of things like that, about how to kind of make their processes better, and it was really, they do great work, and it was really impressive to watch. So it was a good meeting. Other things from you?
Nope.
Okay, folks over here, Mr. Hayden.
Yeah, the zoning subcommittee for the planning board met last week with the date now of town meeting set, special town meeting set. I imagine that they'll be able to refine their list of work rather dramatically. They met, it was a public hearing, a public forum where they took a lot of comments from the public as to what work they might consider prioritizing. A lot of the planning that town meeting has authorized seemed to float up to the top. People were very interested in that number of zoning issues. So stay tuned. There'll be some, I think there'll be a lot for us to consider this fall in the planning board arena.
And they'll be considering further that discussion on Wednesday night with the zoning forum.
Right.
So, plenty of time to offer comment. Thank you. Yeah. Anything else, Mr. Hayden?
Yeah, the town meeting coordinating committees, audio, and it's now becoming an AV subcommittee, met on Wednesday, not Monday, as I said. Adrian very kindly put together a list for me to read tonight of all the good things that happened at that, and I, of course, left it on my desk at work. But it was a good discussion with a number of people who are important in making these things work. You know, Amherst Media was there. Brian Eccleston from the school was there, the technical guy from there. People with hearing aids were there to talk about the issues that they have. It was a great, great forum to really get started. The town meeting coordinating committee are quite committed to making sure that the communications do work better We talked about the new audio in this room, for instance, and how much it's recently improved, or it's been improved for a while, and now it's getting better as we learn how to use it. So we're looking forward to spending some effort and getting town meeting as well to sound better. Some discussion about, you know, there's a lot of meeting places that don't have built-in sound like this room does, where audio, you know, audio issues of being heard are also important. So that's come up. Lighting, the visual part at town meeting was discussed. So I think there'll be a lot of work. I'm looking forward to a lot of work getting done on that and on those issues.
Great, thank you. And I'll just note from the TMCC perspective that I did pass along to them, and you know that because I copied you on it, the memo, the stuff that came out of our discussion last time. I didn't get that to them until last Wednesday, I think, or Thursday, whenever it was. So it was after their most recent meeting, but they're continuing these discussions all summer. And in fact, they're meeting with the moderator and the town manager next week, I believe, to talk about some of this stuff. So they appreciated that report from us. Okay, good. Anything else, Mr. Hayden?
No, thank you.
No, Mr. Wild? Anything? Okay, let's see, a couple things from me. Campus and Community Coalition was supposed to meet tomorrow, but that meeting, or Wednesday, but that meeting has been canceled. What we're trying to do this summer is to look at a strategic plan and kind of a master calendar, much like the Select Board uses, because we've been really doing what we've been doing for several years now, and there are various events or various challenges, various dates that are relevant that come up that are recurring and predictable. So we want to have a calendar and a strategic plan so that the pieces are in place to deal with this stuff. We also want to have a repository of all of the great pieces, communication pieces, brochures, table tents, videos, whatever the different partners in this effort are using, whether it's UMass Police Department, Amherst Police Department, Dean of Students Office, Residence Life, PVTA, the coalition itself, are using to communicate about different issues. We want to kind of have all those things in one place that any one of us can access or at least know, okay, you know, for this upcoming thing, this would be exactly the email that we need to send, or this thing already exists that we want to communicate the bylaws about, whatever. So that is going to be a really, really important and very valuable step forward for the coalition, and that's the summer project. So at the last meeting, we talked a lot about kind of what the year looked like, what the successes and challenges were, and how to move forward, and so that's our plan. We already talked about ZBA. Mr. Wald and I attended the 50th anniversary of the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission on Thursday evening. Mr. Schreiber, who's the town's rep from the planning board, was also there. And it was really a great meeting. It was a great way to be reminded of how much the regional partnerships really matter. There's so much that we can do, there's only so much we can do as individual towns, but working together, really enormous things could happen, like the formation of the PVTA, which was created by or largely led by, driven by Pioneer Valley Planning Commission a long time ago. The regional bike trails is another example. The whole transit thing, transit thing that's happening right now with the Knowledge Corridor. The PVPC is a tremendous resource in bringing together of other resources to make these regional things happen. And congratulations to them for 50 years and really a great kind of reminder to all of us. So that was a great event. And on Wednesday, Ms. Brewer, I just learned, and I are going to be having lunch with a bunch of Amherst College students. I've been talking with the community service learning, whatever they call it, community engagement project, Sarah.
Center for Community Engagement.
Center right. for Community Engagement. The director of that has talked to me at Black Sheep a couple of times and with students to talk about kind of different opportunities and things that the students can learn about and get involved with in town. And so one of the things they want to do is learn more about kind of the, you know, civic engagement itself and public service. And so I understand that 8 students and the director and Ms. Brewer and I are going to have lunch and talk about all these things on Wednesday. So that should be very interesting. And they've got volunteers. These kids will be coming from, not kids, the students will be coming from volunteering at the Survival Center, at Big Brother, Big Sister, in the schools, and several other places, Amherst Media, and a few other places that I can't remember. So so that would be great. I think that's everything I have to talk about. Anything else on liaison stuff or whatever? Oh, okay. I think we covered all of the untimed items. If I did not, then let me know of any glaring omissions. We don't meet again until the 16th. At this point, the things on our calendar for July 16th are the continuance of the liquor license hearing that we opened tonight for Hess. Also, there's going to be a report on the new parking machines, kind of how they have fared, where we are after a year's experience with those. We had originally had that penciled in maybe for tonight, but that just was kind of too big of a thing to put together and consider for tonight, which is good because, you know, now it's 9:30 anyway. So that's what July is looking like. And then we're only going to meet one other time. This is assuming everything works in our favor and nothing critical comes up that we need to meet for. We'll be meeting August 20th, as you know, for the just an evaluation meeting. But our regular select board meeting then will be on the 27th of August. So that is all before we go to executive session. Anybody want to say anything before I make the executive session motion? Okay, then. I move to go into executive session per Mass General Law, Chapter 30A, Section 21A, Subsection 6, to consider the purchase, exchange, lease, or value of real property, as an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the negotiating position of this body, and open session will not reconvene at the conclusion of the executive session. Need a roll call vote.
Brewer, aye.
Stein, aye.
O'Keefe, aye.
Wald, aye.
Hayden, aye.
And that is a roll call vote. So the public session, the open session of this meeting is adjourning at 9:34. Thank you all. See you in July.